Welcome to Talladega, the fastest speedway on earth. The fastest network on Earth welcomes you to the fastest speedway on Earth, where a packed grandstand awaits the Subway 300 NASCAR Busch Series race, presented by Labor Ready. Today on Fox, 43 drivers at the ready, and they'll run upwards of 190 miles an hour. After eight races in the NASCAR Busch Series, Kevin Harvick leads the points. Jason Keller and rookie Greg Biffle off that Nashville win in a dead heat for second. Defending champ Jeff Green sits fourth in the standings after eight races. Let's go right down to the front row of the starting grid and Speedway Illustrated's Dick Bergeron.
Thanks, Mike. Joe Nemechek starts on the pole. He owns the record book at this speedway for this event. Most poles, most wins, most laps led. He is incredibly good in big, fast, boomy, scary joints like Talladega. Starting beside him on the outside of the front row is his teammate, Randy LaJoy. LaJoy has finished as high as second here at Talladega. He's won twice at the sister track, the Daytona Speedway. Guaranteed, these two teammates will hook up and give everybody else in the pack nightmares. To Steve Burns.
Well, Dick, Jeff Purvis feels like he's got a score to settle. He's starting fifth today, but at Daytona, the opening race of the season, he led 65 laps more than anybody else. He got into a last lap tangle with Joe Nemechek, and Jeff Purvis has not won since 1996. Matt Yoakum.
Steve, Talladega is synonymous with first-time Winston Cup winners, but only 9 Busch Series starts. Only one driver's pulled after a career magical first-time win here at Talladega. But today, a pair of 20-somethings, rookies Scott Wimmer and Bobby Hamilton Jr. are trying to change history from row 5. Wimmer has momentum on his side after finishing a career best third last week in Nashville, while Bobby Hamilton Jr. returns to the site where 1 year ago he scored his career best of fourth. But they are just two of 26 drivers who start this 300-mile race still winless in Busch Series competition. To Jeannie Zelasco.
Well, Matt, just 1 point separates Greg Biffle from second place points leader Jason Keller. But here at Talladega, 30 cars separate number 60 from that pole position. This is the farthest back he has started all season, but this is also the first time he starts a race coming off a Busch victory. He got the first of his young career just last weekend in Nashville. Greg Biffle tasted success. He is still hungry, and he's hoping to build on the momentum today, Mike.
Thanks, Jeannie, and welcome everybody to the world's fastest speedway, Talladega. Mike Joy with Darrell Waltrip and Larry McReynolds. Darrell, the rules are different. The aerodynamic rules are different here than in Winston Cup. There's less experience in this field than there will be tomorrow. How will today's race be different?
You hit the nail right on the head, experience. This is a race where you got to have a lot of experience right here, folks. In the cockpit, in the pits, making good calls in the pits, good strategy, and a good spotter upstairs. You got to have everything working for you here today to win this race.
Larry, can you win this race in the pits?
Oh, you definitely can. Strategy. It used to be so nerve-wracking to go into this race on race morning knowing what you needed to do. 113 laps, 2 sets of tires. Tires not that important. Out front is the safest place. Get me to lap 60, have me full of fuel, and you're out there to the end.
Yeah, but there'll be 30 guys all trying to be out front at the same time. That's what makes racing at Talladega so nerve-wracking and so exciting. So get ready.
Today's been one of them slam, bam, thank you, ma'am affairs.
Your black
make you money, so you hide them when you're able. In the land of milk and honey, you must put them on the table. You go back, Jack, do it again. Wheels turning round and round. You go back, Jack, do it again.
Get inside the live racing action with RaceCast. Any driver, every lap. Only at NASCAR.com. America Online keyword, NASCAR.
You've got a lot to show for all your hard work. It's time to reward yourself. We've got just what you need. Long-lasting Chevy trucks. Now through April 30th, get 0.9% APR on a 2001 S10 four-cylinder extended cab, totaling $36.90 in average finance savings. That's 0.9 APR. See dealer for residency and other restrictions. Hurry! Offer ends April 30th, so make your money count at your Chevy dealer now.
Menards is your spring savings headquarters. This four-horse MTD mower converts into either a side discharge or mulching mower. On sale, $139. A 3.5-horse tiller busts up hard soil, only $259. Your kids will have hours of fun with this 14-foot Hedstrom trampoline. On sale, just $169. Add this enclosure for only $139. Spring into savings at Menards.
Save big money at Menards.
Looks like you got a little nick there.
What, this?
It's nothing. Maybe we should get it looked at.
Or maybe we should go get a delicious Mike's Hard Lemonade instead.
You're on.
A hard day calls for a hard lemonade. Make it Mike's.
I've been looking all over for you.
You have?
You're the programmers from a parallel universe, right?
Yeah.
I'm a programmer, too.
You what?
I'm certified in WebSphere, Lotus, DB2, Tivoli, Linux, Unix. I can help you do things.
You can?
I've got the software.
Hey, Meatball, stop daydreaming. We've got a mission to do.
It's a different kind of world. You need a different kind of software.
NASCAR on Fox. It doesn't get any faster.
To Talladega, where the Subway 300 is about to get underway, presented on Fox by Labor Ready. There's the field working its way through turns 3 and 4 on one of the pace laps. Teammates Joe Nemechek and Randy LaJoy will share the front row. LaJoy won from second starting spot in Daytona.
And Jimmy Spencer starting third. You gotta watch this guy. I think he's got a fast car today.
Kevin Harvick, the points leader, has finished lower than eighth only once this year, second at Daytona.
Jeff Purvis, third in the last two Talladega races, and Mike Skinner, top tens in both races he started in at 21.
Todd Bodine, the double zero car, was second in last year's race, but with car owner Buckshot Jones at the wheel.
Bobby Hamilton Jr. here, he was got his best finish here. He finished fourth here last year.
Scott Wimmer, his career best finish, third last week at Nashville.
Rich Bickle making only his second Talladega Busch Series start. Jeff Green, Jamie McMurray, the rookie 11th at Daytona, and Mike McLaughlin.
Jason Keller, he's finished second last week at Nashville.
Matt Kenseth, three top tens in four Talladega races.
Rookie Larry Foyt and Jay Sauter, who was third in Texas. Hank Parker Jr. and Lyndon Amick making his first start since Daytona. Kevin Grubb is there.
15. And Kenny Wallace, he's been struggling here lately. Had a great start this season, but's been struggling lately.
Tim Fedewa, the Bristol runner-up, and Elton Sawyer. Tony Raines back there with Mark Green, who was seventh here last year.
How about Skip Smith, a retired police officer from Pennsylvania, making his first Busch start?
Former champ David Green, Jimmy Johnson, and Ashton Lewis Jr. in the 15th row.
And there's Greg Biffle, Nashville winner last week.
And Shauna Robinson, who's DNF'd early in both of her previous starts. Rookie Brad Baker and Marty Houston, two rookies. Christian Elder and David Starr, a couple more young guns.
And Chad Little won this race in 1995.
Shane Hall, 12th at Daytona, only top 20 of 2001. Little miscue yesterday, lots of repairs this morning on that car.
David Donahue and Mike Harmon. Andy Kirby from Nashville. Joe Bessie, 17th at Daytona. And Bobby Gerhardt, in his second Busch Series start. That's the 43-car field. As today, they'll go 300 miles, 113 laps at the Talladega Super Speedway. Posted awards totaling nearly $1 million.
And 50 to 55 laps on a pit window. That's a few laps shy of being able to make this race on one stop. So some of the guys was talking about maybe getting in early and being able to do it on one stop later on in the race.
We'll ride along with six different drivers in today's race.
And we should have some exciting shots for these folks at home today, because these guys are gonna mix it up, and they're gonna mix it up around the start. Right now they're riding around checking pit road speeds. That's kind of what you do under the caution here before you take the green. Get your pit road speed on your tack so you know what to do when you come down pit lane.
Here we see the weather, air temperature 81 degrees, track temperature about 20 degrees warmer to 101. We'll keep a monitor on that and see if it goes up. Can definitely make these cars start sliding around, but that air temperature, that's what the engine guys worry about. Motor tuning, so important here.
Getting set for the green flag as they come off turn number four. Remember that unlike Daytona, a similarly shaped speedway where the start finish line is right in the middle of the trioval at the center of pit road at Daytona, that start finish line would be here, but at Talladega it's way down here on the way to turn number one, and a lot of passing and a lot can happen in that distance.
Yeah, if you come off turn four, you're leading the race, probably got it won. Here you come off turn four, you just now got your battle set up.
All right,
here we go, guys. Pull on those belts one more time. 113 laps, 7 out of the top 10 cars. Pontiacs, they added a half inch of spoiler to these guys since Daytona. They're still fast.
Auburn University football coach Tommy Tuberville has the green flag in hand, and we're racing at Talladega.
Green flag. And Harvick is all over the back of Randy LaJoie, pushing him to the start.
Joy, though, puts a little distance on Harvick. Nemechek leads the train in the low lane.
Well, Harvick was shoving him. I mean, he was up there pushing on him, getting him going, and it paid off for Randy LaJoie. It didn't do a lot for Harvick.
Look at Jimmy Spencer in that one car, the orange car. He wants to get down there to the bottom. He was fast in practice yesterday.
Harvick falls into second place and got off to a good start, you guys.
Nemechek runs up a little high, and Mike Skinner is there, and already we're three wide.
I bet that Nemechek didn't expect to be caught in the middle three wide on the first lap. I bet he thought he'd be out there where Randy is. And he's going backwards.
Darrell, there's 42 other drivers that know just how fast that 87 is here at Talladega. And if they can close line him early, they will if they can.
Yeah, I got a feeling the only friend he's got out there is his teammate, Randy LaJoie. The rest of them are going to try to put him as far to the back as they can. These cars race quite a bit differently than the Winston Cup cars, because these cars do not have the aerodynamic adjustments made to them that the Winston Cup cars do.
But what they try to do, what the Busch officials try to do, Darrell, is do it with some of the chassis. They have to run a minimum of 1,500-pound springs in the front, where there is no rule on Winston Cup cars. 415-pound springs in the rear, minimum, where Winston Cup is 350. They can race a rear sway bar. They run a 390 carburetor with a 29/32nd plate, which is a 32nd smaller than the Cup cars, and 55 degrees of spoiler on these things, minimum.
And quite frankly, I mean, as a driver, I believe I would like this package much better. I think I would like my car better. It would drive better, handle better, and I think it actually race better.
Joe Nemechek, Darrell, got kicked from the pole back to ninth place.
But here he comes down on the inside there, looking underneath the 21 car, and there he goes, and he'll be back up there before too long. They must have been a little loaded up on him when he took the green.
Nemechek passes Mike Skinner. Puts him up into seventh spot.
I think it just shows you how critical right off here at the track position and staying in line is. Harvick is sliding back now.
Joe Bessie's return to Busch Series Racing lasted one lap. The engine expired and Bessie's in the garage. Jimmy Spencer underneath Randy LaJoie for the lead.
He's got help. Jeff Purvis, an 18 car, looking out the front of this race car.
Outside.
And that's what the spotter will be telling you.
Clear.
You've got the help.
Clear.
You've got the help. In other words, your line is moving. Keep going where you're going.
This car of Jeff Purvis, a brand new race car. These guys just barely got it finished to come down here. No testing, no wind tunnel. Was fast right out of the truck.
Folks, it's like being on the interstate and trying to pick the right lane through that traffic jam, except here, you're changing lanes at 190 miles an hour.
Yeah, if you had blinkers on this car, turn signals on this car, you wouldn't last long because you'd burn the bulbs out.
Jimmy Spencer becomes the race's second leader. Jeff Purvis is up to second. Randy LaJoie kicked to third. Todd Bodine and Joe Nemechek are the top five here at Talladega. And it's a 42-car pack for the lead.
The Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready on Fox is brought to you by Subway, showing the world how great a fresh sandwich can taste. Subway, fresh. By Smooth Bush Beer and Easy Drinking Bush Light. Bush, the proud sponsor of the NASCAR Bush Series. By Pep Boys, cars like us, people love us. And by Labor Ready, dependable temporary labor guaranteed.
Jimmy Spencer pulls a fast freight train around Talladega. 41 cars in that lead and only draft.
And you might say, why would these cars have a different aerodynamic package than, say, the Winston Cup cars do? Folks, watch this race today. You see how these cars are already single file and they're kind of following each other? You will not, I repeat, you will not see that happen tomorrow at any point in time.
Couple of the rookies getting ready to rumble here, Darrell. You saw 14 Larry Foyt and the 60 of Greg Biffle trying to bust through. Racing back at 27th place. There they are in the bottom groove.
Greg Biffle, last week's winner from Nashville. He's back in this pack in a 60 car.
You know, I watched him run yesterday in happy hour. His car was handling really well, but it didn't seem to have the straightaway speed that some of the other cars had.
That's three rookies right in a row. Add the 25, David Donahue, who's now in the Ed Renzi car, replacing Chad Chaffin. Right behind the 60 of Biffle.
If you're back in this pack here, you're just hoping everybody will eventually get lined up single file, or you can get with some cars that are moving forward and try to make yourself catch back up with that lead pack. Because if you don't do that pretty quickly here, that lead pack is long gone.
What's happened to the lead pack? It's 11 cars. They've gotten single file, and they're pulling away slowly but surely from this group. So it's important, this group, and I know that's easier said than done. They're going to have to get in single file, or this group's just going to keep going away from them.
But quite honestly, this is the kind of racing they like to see in this series. Because unlike Winston Cup, where they can run four and five wide and kind of get away with it, these guys don't have that experience that I was talking about. So this lets them separate out a little bit, get into some broken up groups, maybe 10 or 12 cars in each pack. It makes it a little safer racing.
11 cars have broken away at the front. They're all single file, and it's double file from 12th on back, and that there you see the difference. And you see that gap that's opened up. That's about a second between the 11th and 12th place cars
now
right
these,
there.
These guys back in here, they can catch back up once they get single file, but they'll never do it running side by side.
Yeah, those leaders can run, but they can't hide if they get single file behind them, Steve Burns.
Jeff Green is in the 11th position. They blew a motor in happy hour yesterday. They were pretty happy with the motor they put in, the backup motor, but they didn't get any time on it. And Jeff Green is reporting now that it feels like it's laboring, struggling. So Jeff Green not happy with the motor in that number 10 car. Matt Yoakum?
Steve, right now the plans for Joe Nemechek is just to ride and help run out the clock. In the last 3 years, 5,000 miles of testing here in Talladega. What you're looking at is the team's notebook. They call it the Talladega Bible. Look how thick that thing is with all kinds of different chassis measurements. They know what they need to have here to win. It's proven well in the past. And they know right now, just ride out the clock and play by their own schedule.
Thanks, Matt. Spencer, the leader. LaJoie right with him in second. Todd Bodine, Joe Nemechek, Mike Skinner, Scott Wimmer, one of the rookies, Kevin Harvick, Jeff Purvis, Mike McLaughlin, Bobby Hamilton Jr., and Jeff Green. That's the lead draft, lead change.
That double zero car runs second here last year, so that car, they got a good setup for this joint, too.
They got Spencer, and that one car kicked up on the high side. Todd Bodine in that double zero. Joe Nemechek, here he comes.
Now, no help for Spencer, though.
These are all Pontiacs at the front. Now, most of these teams at the front run Chevrolets on the shorter tracks, but they feel it with the Busch Series rules that the Pontiac may have an aerodynamic advantage, so they build one just for Daytona Talladega.
You can hide the rear spoiler on a Pontiac better than you can on these other cars. The way the body configuration is around the back glass and the trunk lid, you can really hide the spoiler better. And here comes this other pack of cars. And when Spencer shook out a line, that slowed that front pack down. These guys here got a chance of catching up, but they got to capitalize in a hurry.
Well, they finally realized that front group was getting smaller and smaller. They needed to get in line and do something. Here you see now they're getting lined up.
And there can be as much as a second to a second and a half difference in lap speeds of the cars lined up and these guys back in here racing each other.
There you see Bobby Hamilton Jr. in a 26 car, Jeff Green. These guys had lost this draft. They started racing side by side. Now they're catching up. We're looking at the back of Bobby Hamilton Jr.'s car. This is a old Monte Carlo. This is not the current Monte Carlo. These guys did a test, the old 99 Monte Carlo versus the new one. This one was a little bit quicker. They elected to bring it here since it was faster.
Hamilton, you see him drop in behind the 10 car. And there's the gap from these 11 cars to 12. And on back, it's now up to 2.5 seconds.
Now this group's getting back lined up, so if this other group don't stay lined up, which they're doing a pretty good job right now, but that's gonna be a tough pack to catch if they stay single file.
Jay Sauter leads that second pack from 12th place. Jason Keller, Lyndon Amick with him, Kevin Grubb, Matt Kenseth, Mark Green, Elton Sawyer, David Green, and Tim Sauter. Larry Foyt on the inside there. David Starr going past in the 16.
'28 car, Brad Baker. He picked up a new paint job this week.
Look at the hood on David Starr's car there. And it looked like the top of that hood is just wobbling a little bit there on the left side.
Yeah, if you see it right there, there's a hinge right there. It looks like it's broke loose. That's normally a welded hinge on the hood and on the fender that has a bolt through it. Either the bolt's come out. Looks like possibly the bolt has come out of it.
I believe it has. He's going to have to come in and put him a bungee cord on that baby.
And that'll really affect the aerodynamics of the car. You know, that causes turbulence, and that's something you just don't want here. You don't want turbulence.
Well, turbulence is underneath the hood here in traffic. It really buffs the car around, bucks the car up in the air. It's quite violent at times, and that's why that hood has come loose.
18, Jeff Purvis had a look on the inside of Kevin Harvick there for sixth place, but they stay single file in that front pack. And now it looks like Hamilton has lost touch with that group and maybe also Mike McLaughlin. 14 laps complete at Talladega in the Subway 300.
Welcome back to the Subway 300 as we come to you from Talladega on Fox. Earlier, we showed you Happy Hour, the Winston Cup cars on FX, tuning up for tomorrow. And we got a great lineup. NASCAR this morning at 10 Eastern. Bill Engel will show you restrictor plate engine testing to prepare you for the Talladega 500 on Fox, the pre-race show at 12:30 Eastern. Tony Stewart will join us here at the Hollywood Hotel to get ready for the race in the NASCAR Victory Lane. Wraps everything up again on Fox Sports Net at 9 o'clock. Jeff Hammond, as we got a look here at the Busch race. You know, Jeff Green, who was the points leader last year, this was the race that after he came out of here and went to California, he was the points leader and never let go. He's fourth currently in points and right now having some trouble in this race, running ninth, but blew an engine with about 5 minutes to go through test. So he had a new engine that was fired up for the first time when he started this race.
Yes, I talked to Harold Holly just before the race. They had some concerns, but that engine is prepared by Roush Racing, and they were assured that the engine they had just lost was only about a 1 horsepower differential. So they felt very confident that they could start this race today, rely on what testing information it did have to be able to go into the race. Unfortunately, it doesn't seem like he's running what they expected him to do.
But he feels he's a little bit ahead of last year because he already has a victory with Darlington. He didn't win his first race until Richmond last year. Let's go back up to the booth.
Well, Bobby Hamilton Jr. has drifted back to lead the second pack. Joe Nemechek is our new race leader. But we're back here with Hamilton and Jason Keller, 11th and 12th place.
And as you look in your rear view mirror, you say, raw, where'd those guys come from? Because they were not even in sight 10 laps ago. And here they are. They're going to catch right back up to this lead crowd.
Well, the lead pack, you see them battling side by side, and that 2.5 second gap, that has really shrunk and brought the second pack right there.
And a couple of good cars fell back, the 10 car and the 26 of Bobby Hamilton Jr. They got shook out a little bit, but they were fast enough to help these guys get back up there.
We no longer have the first pack and the second pack. We have a big pack once again.
It's like who let the dogs out, because here they come.
Looks like 27 cars now in that lead draft. And oh, by the way, order has come now to the second pack because they want back up in it.
And so much of this is stimulated from the spotters.
Right.
The spotters are going back and forth saying, look, guys, we need to get in line. That pack's getting away from us. The 16 car, David Starr, he was on pit road. We heard that he received the black flag, had to repair that hood. We got another lead change working.
Kevin Harvick comes from third up toward first. Nemechek right there.
And the more these guys do this in the front, as you can see, it's just pulling that other crowd right into the mix. And that's the last thing you really want, particularly if you're at the tail end of this crowd here.
Well, they went and sniffed a draft off a lapped car, and Mike Skinner sniffed it all the way to the front. So Skinner, the new leader. Nemechek, oh, a bump there. Harvick and LaJoy got together.
That's kind of like what you do at Talladega. These cars will have a wheel marks on them.
Look at these guys.
Boy.
Look at them. Three wide, coming off the corner, turn two, bumping and banging at 192 miles an hour.
And Harvick's drifting back. Todd Bodine got knocked out of that top 10, and Harvick as well.
There's Jason Keller. He's pulled himself into the fight.
Bobby Hamilton Jr. looking out the back of his car. He helped pull Jason Keller and this group back up there to the front.
Boy, Darrell, you don't have to lose much momentum to go way back. Lose a lot.
These cars got a 390 carburetor on them, and when you lift the throttle up a little bit, then it takes a little time to recover.
And that's 390 CFM versus the Winston Cup cars will run a 750 or an 830.
Randy LaJoy being shuffled back on the high side now.
These guys are racing about at the speeds they qualified, just a teeny bit slower, whereas I saw some smoke out of somebody there.
Was that Wimmer who dropped to the inside?
Boy, I don't know, but everybody did a good job of avoiding any trouble there.
That's Scott Wimmer. Big puff of smoke.
Let me tell you, that something like that could create a disaster. You really have to be calm and cool when you see something like that happening. You can't jerk these cars around like you do at Martinsville or short tracks. You got to be calm.
Hate to see that for Scott Wimmer. Had a great run at Nashville. These guys just getting better and better each week with this race team.
Yeah, he's a good little driver, and he's interesting to talk to. Comes from a good racing family.
Purvis drops back in line after a run at the high side. Here comes Spencer on the outside.
And he's got help from that 10 car, Jeff Green, up to the high side right here. Side by side.
Now Green has come from 2.5 seconds off the lead draft. In five laps, he's fighting for the lead.
Well, you know, last week at Nashville on the start of the race, he complained about the engine, the transmission, a lot of things wasn't right about the car. Next thing we knew, he was leading the race, and it's kind of that same scenario again today.
I want to show you again what happened with Scott Wimmer.
Looking inside.
Here he is right down there in line, you know, kind of following along with everybody else, and all of a sudden, man, oof. Fortunately, no fluids.
Big trouble off turn four. And one car, Harvick, goes spinning to the infield. Oh. Caution is out.
Lots of damage to the rear of that.
Well, he was falling back, and I think the car, maybe the handle had gone away on the car, and he was just trying to ride it out to make a pit stop, but I know this wasn't what he had planned. That car is torn up.
Harvick had a 91-point lead coming into this race, and that will not be enough. So it's the first caution of the day in this Subway 300.
Talladega has a way of changing the point situation.
And it will today.
Quite honestly, that's for Talladega, a one-car accident. We don't see that very often.
No, we don't. This is something we have not seen very much either, and that's Kevin Harvick's car tore up this bad.
From aerodynamics to recyclodynamics, I think. Much of that rear end.
They're going to have to go behind the wall, and NASCAR very critical here. They will give them one chance to fix this race car.
Let's see if we can see what happened here, Larry. He had drifted back. Oh, he's just down on the bottom there. I don't know if he got tapped or not.
Well, he was lucky, though. He was shooting back up the racetrack.
Let's see if he comes into view here. Already gone.
He may have gotten a little help. There you see the roof flaps deploy, but he still hit that outside wall hard.
Everybody did a good job, really good job of avoiding that spinning car. That's so hard to do here. That's all attributed to the spotter and directing you as you go by.
And no way to tell if there was contact that sent Harvick into the spin.
And there's no question, working with Richard Childress Racing, these guys will have a frame machine in the garage, and they will have to bend that rear of that frame back up, get that sheet metal back on it, get him back out there, accumulate as many points as they can.
So far, his worst finish of the year, 12th at Las Vegas. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Talladega, where it's pit stop time. Under caution, Joe Nemechek, Jeff Green, Jimmy Spencer, top to bottom there. Nemechek has the last pit on pit road, Nick Bergeron.
Jimmy Spencer delighted with his race car, called for no change, just a two-tire change. He had been working with Purvis, but he got out way ahead of Purvis. To Matt.
A two-tire stop for Joe Nemechek. He's already pulled off pit road. No adjustments on the 87. To Steve.
Matt, same strategy for Jeff Green in that number 10. Just right side tires of fuel, small chassis, wedge adjustment to the right rear of this car.
All the lead lap cars, which means all the cars on the track. Just about. David Starr is the only car that is not on the lead lap. He had that black flag stop.
And we felt like that would be the strategy. 20-something laps on the tires. Biggest thing, get in there, get it full of gas. Go ahead, get your two tires. But Joe Nemechek in 87, he won the race off pit road again. Qualified on the pole. They picked their pits by how they qualified. He had an in pit. He only had to move about 10 or 12 feet before he beat the race off pit road.
And the hood up on the 66 of Tim Fedewa. Now look way ahead, way up the track on the low side. There goes Harvick.
Hard to really say there, just very lucky it was only one car involved.
So it's the first caution of the day at lap 24 for Kevin Harvick's crash into the outside wall exiting turn four. Pit stops complete. He's ready to go racing. How about you? We'll be back with more of the Subway 300 on Fox.
Fox welcomes you back to Talladega, Alabama. Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready. Front row Joe Nemechek here later. We had our first caution of the day with Jeff Hammond on the Hollywood Hotel just above Victory Circle here. Time to look at the pit strategy here. An early pit stop, and it could change things for the long haul of this race.
Chris, right now, if everything goes green, the guys got the break they were looking for. They can now go run 50 laps, make one more stop, and finish the race out. This was something that a lot of the teams were talking about. They wanted to be able to try to stretch it to halfway. They couldn't do it. So therefore, now they got the situation where they're in that window. This will make everybody a lot happier.
All right.
As far as their strategy.
The caution lap, Jeff, on lap 25 with obviously Kevin Harvick. We've had seven lead changes, five different leaders. Let's get on to pit road now on Jeannie. Jeannie?
Well, Chris, no complaints, so no real adjustments to the 35 car, Lyndon Hammack. How can you complain? You started 20th, you moved to 9th. Just some fuel, some tire, and they moved some tape. But we should point out, Shauna Robinson of the 99 car making her second pit stop. She took two right side tires the first time. She's coming here for the left side. Dick?
Jimmy Spencer and Jason Keller had identical pit strategies. Both took right side tires only and fuel and no adjustments to their race car. Jeff Purvis, on the other hand, took four tires and adjusted the track bar. Steve Burns.
Dick, interesting strategy also for Todd Bodine in that 00. Same thing. He wants to take four tires now, take two tires if they make just one more stop. Todd Bodine giving up a little track position for later on in the race. To Matt Yoho.
Randy LaJoy will restart from the sixth position. I spoke with his crew chief, Wally Rogers. A 9.1 second pit stop, two tires, one can of gas. Just like pre-race schedule, they were hoping to maybe go two tires in the first stop and maybe only a gas and go later in the race. But the big thing for Joe Nemechek, his teammate, real estate, real estate, real estate, the location, the final pit stall here at the end of pit road. Two tires and a can of gas, and he let everybody off to take the lead.
Yeah, that's like having lakefront property, man, having that last pit stall right there at the end of pit road. And there is Nemechek behind the safety car with that, Mike Skinner and Green.
That pit stall is always an advantage under caution. It's a little bit iffy there under green because you lose so much ground leaving pit road. But under caution, she is prime real estate. There's Joe Nemechek's pit right there. And there's all he had to do to move to that line to beat everybody off.
Field coming out of turn number four. Now they're still more than a mile from the start finish line. But when they get there, those of you with surround sound are going to want to enjoy all this horsepower and all this speed and fury of Talladega. So we're going to kind of lean back on this restart and let you folks crank it up. On that restart, 57, Jason Keller was very slow coming up to speed. He restarted eighth. He's going to be back around 20th.
And you never know, he could have missed a gear. And again, gear selection is critical here, particularly when you're back in the field. On the restarts, you got to anticipate those restarts. Oh, he missed a shift, I believe.
And got out of the way.
Yeah, and he knew it, and he jumped down out of the way.
And, of course, that will turn a lot of RPMs, and I'm sure right now what they're going to be on pins and needles, did he damage the motor? And that had to be a hard stop because, remember, he's second in points. Our points leader's behind the wall repairing a wreck, so they can make a lot of ground on points right here, Dick Bergman.
Kevin Harvick had been running at the finish of 36 consecutive events. He had run every single lap this year except one, but he's in big trouble now. They've got a frame machine under the car. Will Lind has a porta power on the left side. This thing is absolutely all torn up. Kevin Harvick, what happened to you?
Well, we all checked up there, and one of us, whoever was behind us, didn't check up. Unfortunate for AC Delco, Slovenia, and Sonic. We had a good car. I pushed Skinner out in the lead. His car was running hot, and unfortunately, I had to stay high because mine was running hot, too, and it got us mixed up back there and went totally against our game plan, but we had to keep the motor under it. So this is what wins championships right here, everybody coming together, and nobody better in this team right here.
And when he says everybody, they got the Winston Cup team and the Busch team. There's no limit to the number of people who can work on this thing. And I'll tell you what, they've got an awful lot of them here, about a dozen people working on this car.
Well, Dickie came here with a 91-point lead, and he will have to get back out on the track to salvage any hope of staying in the first five in points.
And with the equipment they have at their disposal down there, that frame machine, and backing it into the wall, better to tear up the back of the car. You can fix that and get back out there. He surprisingly won't be in that bad a shape when he gets back on the racetrack.
Two-wide battle here for fourth, Darrell. Randy LaJoie and Jimmy Spencer, a couple of old battling veterans from NASCAR's modified division, and a former modified champ, Mike McLaughlin, right there with him in the 20 car.
And talk about Mike McLaughlin in the 20 car. Started in 14th. Talked to those guys this morning. They said this car, it needs help. If it's got a little bit of help behind it to push it through the air, it will go. It just will not go by itself.
That's usually a sign the car has a lot of drag in it. The car doesn't have as slick a body on it maybe as some of the other cars do, but when you put it around people, take some of that air off of it, it'll go.
He's right in the middle of that lead draft. McLaughlin with Kevin Grubb right behind him in 37.
Now, a car like that's fun to drive, but you can't get out front with it, because when you do, you'll just get passed right back. But it makes it a lot easier to drive when they're like that.
The Dr. Pepper cam with Bobby Hamilton Jr. There's Grubb moving past on the inside. Hamilton stuck up in the high groove, and he's going to pay the price. Drift back a ways.
He has not a whole lot of help up there.
Just got to kind of fall back there until your spotter says you're clear behind the whatever car that was he just passed, but he'll find him a hole and drop him down in there.
Boy, the spotters, they play such a role here. As a crew chief, I would normally not say a whole lot on the radio. Every once in a while, I may ask what the temperatures are, how's the car driving, but you leave the radio to the spotter where he can communicate.
Darrell, some spotters are former drivers, others are not. Do you have a preference whether or not to have someone who's been in this type of race car spotting for you?
A spotter can do so much if he knows, if he's had the experience. He can tell you how other cars are running, what kind of line they're running. He can give you some lap times. He can watch what happens in the pits. But he's got to, I think a former driver would be a great, not only spotter, but coach.
Mike Skinner in the 21 car, he's hung on the outside, restarted this restart in second. Now he's hung on the high side with no help behind him. This racetrack is so big, he falls back in line here, falls all the way back to about eighth. But this racetrack is so big, you have to have two spotters.
Look how high Randy LaJoie in the 7 had to go because he and Spencer nearly bumped again. This will probably go on all day.
Yeah, that's a couple of hard places right there. You don't want to get in between them.
And, of course, the one car is the car that Randy LaJoie drove for the last 2 years. Actually won at Daytona a couple of 3 years ago.
Right. And, you know, inevitably, on a pit stop, guys will make changes to their cars. Sometimes they're real subtle, but they'll make changes to their cars, and then all of a sudden they can get up there and race with these guys. Biffle in that 60 car. This should be his kind of race and his kind of racetrack because he likes to hang it out.
Well, he and Kenseth hooked up and they picked up two positions in the last lap.
Yeah, they're 13th and 14th, and Biffle, remember, started in 31st position.
Jimmy Johnson right there.
That's a team that I understand is looking for a driver next year. Johnson's going to go to Winston Cup, and they've kind of got the help wanted sign out for next season for that 92.
He's going to Winston Cup, but they're already working closely with the Hendrick organization where he's going to be going. This is a Hendrick chassis he is racing here. Hendrick builds their own chassis.
They had quite a few Busch cars. Jeff Gordon had a couple, and Ricky Hendrick had a couple of Busch cars and had good luck with them. Jeff Gordon won at Homestead last year in one of those cars.
Still out there. Still there on the corner.
Looking back from the Briggs & Stratton camera on board Kenny Wallace.
Clear, all around.
Right behind single now is Randy LaJoie. They've settled out single file, and right behind him, Jeff Purvis.
He's in the MBNA car, and a while ago when we looked out the back bumper, he was a little bitty black dot way out there. He has pulled right back up to the rear bumper of this group.
Darrell, you're not out of this race until you're in the garage, are you?
Oh, no. No, this is the kind of race where as long as you can see the leaders and you get around the right people, you can always catch back up.
Now, Jeff Green has quietly fought his way to second place right behind Joe Nemechek. Let's go to his pit and Steve.
Mike, as Jeff Hammond said, they changed the motor in that number 10 car during happy hour yesterday. They blew a motor. Jeff says the motor is good. It's not as good as his original engine, but he needs to stay behind the leader. The crew chief, Harold Holly, you see there in the corner of your screen, he grew up 12 miles from this racetrack in Pell City, Alabama. He wants to win here badly. Let's go to Dick Bergeron.
And one of Jeff Green's crew members was just down here and talking to Jimmy Spencer's Johnny Allen. He is the crew chief for Spencer. Told him he wants to lead a lap. Spencer has agreed to work with him. So they're going to try to hook up so that number 10 car of Green can lead a lap.
Well, Spencer there lined up right behind Green. But it's going to take some doing to push their way past that fast Pontiac of Joe Nemechek.
And what they did is they fell back just a little bit, let Nemechek get out there a few car lengths. Then they tried to run him down off turn two, but I don't think they're fast enough to do it.
A big lead looks good anywhere except at Talladega. You get too much of a lead, they'll get a run on you.
Oh, you're a setting duck.
Five laps to go at the world's fastest speedway. Winston Cup racing the Talladega 500 tomorrow. More Busch Series action after this. Welcome back to the Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready. Joe Nemechek the leader. Jimmy Spencer was running third. Jeff Green pulled out to pass, and he did, but he passed backward. What do they say on that show? Goodbye.
Yeah.
11th place.
Look at this crowd, though, guys. 80-something degrees, and it's only Saturday.
Oh, yeah, all these people came out of those motorhomes and campers that are parked all over this joint.
And they'll be partying until the race starts tomorrow. This is kind of like spring break for those of us inland up here at Talladega this weekend.
Well, they snaked their way down that back straightaway. Everybody's just looking for a little air to sniff.
Andy Kirby there in that black 49. And he's moved up from 40th starting spot.
It's a Nashville boy. Got all his spirits on that Nashville Fairground Speedway.
Former track champion there.
Sir. 19 spots he's picked up since the start of this race.
That's, you got to do that here. You just got to be patient. You got to pick and choose who you go by, when you go by them. It's a long, long race.
Yeah, most of the time people will tell you before this race ever starts, it doesn't matter where you start at Talladega. You can start anywhere and win this race.
No, it just matters if you finish.
If you finish.
Well, the meat and the sandwich there is Rich Bickle. Nick Parker underneath him as they went three wide and continue to.
Rich Bickle in the 59 car. That also, like Bobby Hamilton Jr., is one of the older Monte Carlos, but has a Richard Childress engine in that car.
Qualified really well. Qualified 10th, and that's really really well for Bickle and those guys.
The 10 of Jeff Green trying to fight his way back to the front. He got shuffled from second back to 11th, and now he's got right there lined up on him for a little bit of help, Greg Biffle in the 60.
Jason Keller in the 57 car, he was going to go below out of bounds.
Well, he's
going down into turn one.
Yeah, he's Green's teammate. If he can get to him.
I think that's what the deal is. He's trying to get up there to help him, but he just can't quite get there.
Well, and you can see why from this shot.
The serpentine has begun down the backstretch.
Bill Bonnet invented that. At Pocono. Coming off turn three, the final turn.
Still got one looking inside.
You can disturb the draft, and out of those 10 cars, if you can lose one car by doing that, you've accomplished what you needed to do.
I've seen Biffle do that in the truck series, Michigan, California. Just incredible sometimes the erratic moves he would make to shake that guy behind him.
Boy, Kenny Wallace in the 48 car, he dove behind Randy LaJoie in the 7th, then he jumped up behind Kevin Grubb in the 37 car, leaving Randy LaJoie on the bottom.
See LaJoie just out of frame there on the left of Kenny Wallace and Kevin Grubb.
This is a good run for Kenny Wallace. Of course, missed the Winston Cup show for tomorrow. Will not be competing in the show tomorrow.
You heard the spotter talking about a black flag, and that would be for LaJoie. It's reported that
you can see oil all over the back of the car there. So he's definitely got an oil leak of some nature. Boy, and it doesn't take hardly anything. A loose oil line, just barely loose, or something in the rear end, just anything, it makes a big mess on the back of these cars.
Boy, this has got to be disappointing. I talked to Randy last night. He was so happy with his race car. Remember, he won the other Busch Grand National Restrictor Plate race earlier this year, the season opener at Daytona.
And the thing about these cars, they only run these cars twice a year. They run them at Daytona, and they run them once here. And so a lot of guys don't have what they would prefer to have for Daytona and Talladega because they can't afford to build a special car for two races.
Kenseth on the inside, Mike Skinner, Jimmy Johnson. And they get back to just
wide,
two wide.
Racing.
I think what we'll see before this day is over with is there'll be two distinctive lines, one on the inside, one on the outside, and then it becomes a matter of which one is going to make, which line is going to go.
All right, 10-4, we'll get it. Get him off the track, man. He's dumping like crazy. They're black flagging him every time here now. Double wide, still outside.
Matt Kenseth and his spotter Mike Kalinoff talking about Randy LaJoie, who has received the black flag, and I'll have to acknowledge that this time around.
And one reason so many drivers behind him will be complaining, not only does your windshield get so sandblasted here because of the speeds, a little bit of oil, boys, some of the windshields, I've heard the driver complain, I can't see out of my windshield. I'd say, man, you can't complain about that. You'd get in the garage, it's like, how in the world did you ever see out of that race car?
Exactly. That's the way you crew chiefs always treat us drivers. Like, how can you complain about that? Such a good race car.
Looking out the windshield of Matt Kenseth right here, this is not bad right now. This is not good, but this is not near what it'll be when the end of this race comes.
And they do have tear-offs. And so on a pit stop, when they come down pit lane, they can rip off one layer and have a clean windshield.
LaJoie acknowledges the black flag and comes in to have the rear end checked. Matt?
Well, they were talking while Randy was out on the racetrack that indeed some kind of smoke was coming into the cockpit of the car. They were trying to hold off till a caution, but then NASCAR did black flag them. They're going to take a look, raise the hood, see if they can figure out what it is indeed that is smoking and possibly leaking. Oh, NASCAR officials are waving them off.
Yeah, they're done.
Whatever it is, it's pretty serious that he can look under there and see it that quickly. Of course, it'll make it easy to fix.
They're trying to jack that thing up there and see if they can look underneath it and see what they can find.
And let's show you where that smoke started to come out from LaJoy.
You can just see a real fine mist kind of blowing up behind the back of the car. There you go. Just that quickly, you go from being a contender to being in the garage area.
Okay, what meanwhile, I Matt Kenseth may be joining them there.
Take a look, see what's wrong. Travis Howie gets left, get a yellow, and then I'll try to fix it.
So a problem on Kenseth's car that he's going to try to ride out to the next caution flag.
Well, that's very smart because, you know, they may get a caution and then they could come in and see. If you come to pit road here, these cars have to run at 190 miles an hour, pit road speed 55 miles an hour, plus the repair, you know, you're gonna get lapped just stopping in your pits.
And you're gonna stay out there until you're just about to go a lap down. There's no need coming in until you're either just about to go a lap down or you just get lapped, because you never know when that caution's gonna fly. And all that turbulence under the hood here, I've had it blow off spark plug wires. So it may just be a matter of coming in, putting a wire back on and having at it.
Steve, what's the problem with Kenseth?
But just talking to the team, they burned a piston and lost a cylinder for the 17 of Matt Kenseth.
Tough break for Kenseth. Only one caution so far today. Jimmy Spencer leads Joe Nemechek and Mike McLaughlin here at Talladega. We'll be right back.
Temporary labor guaranteed by Red Wing Comfort Force Work Boots with Supersole 2.0, boots that work all day. By Napa Auto Parts, Napa, we keep America running. And by Subway, showing the world how great a fresh sandwich can taste. Subway, eat fresh.
Welcome back live to Talladega, Alabama. Glad you're spending your weekend on Fox. Tonight, it's COP's 15 greatest moments of all time. Don't miss this outrageous two-hour COP special event tonight at 8 Eastern, 7 Central, only on Fox. That's right. Thanks for tuning in. You're watching the Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready. Cops everywhere will be glued to the set tonight. A major crowd. You know, the population of Talladega, only about 20,000. Have 180,000 tomorrow. Great crowd today watching the Busch race. Joe Nemechek 2 years ago, Jeff Hammond, lost by a bumper to Terry Labonte in the Busch race. He's the only two-time winner in the, this, of course, the 10th Busch race at Talladega. He has slipped now from the lead to second. How is that position considering where we are in this race?
I think Joe is exactly where he wants to be. He's kind of sizing up his competition, figuring out where he needs to be as the race kind of comes to a conclusion. He realizes he's still got to make one more pit stop, and that'll kind of set the stage as far as where he needs to be. But if he understands a weakness maybe in Spencer or the couple of guys he's racing around behind him, Skinner, Purvis, that way he'll know whether he wants to be leading or wants to be running second or toward the end. I think it's some good strategies on his part. He's a real smart racer. He knows how to win here at Talladega.
Former Busch Rookie of the Year winner and won a Busch Points Championship in 92. Mike, oh, let's go down to Matt. Matt Yocum is with Randy LaJoy.
Well, the seven car, Chris, has pulled behind the wall. The crew guy's taking a look. Wally Rogers, the crew chief, actually looking at the Oberg filter, trying to see if any metal might have stuck on that filter, signifying maybe an engine problem. Randy LaJoy entered this race ninth in points. Randy, what happened?
I'm not quite sure. We had a good race car. His car was running great. I started getting a little bit of smoke inside. Come in and got an oil leak somewhere. I lost a lot of oil. I don't think it hurt the motor, but we'll try to find a leak, put some oil in it, go back out, make some laps.
A tough break for Randy LaJoy. Came in this, like we said, ninth in points, only 78 markers out of fifth. Tough break. So that's changed.
Unscheduled pit stop, Hank Parker.
Going under the hood. Several guys have the engine trouble. The 17's out there running around with something wrong with it. And
knocking pretty bad, Billy.
It don't sound very good, even through our audio right there at all. Motor didn't sound good at all.
It sounds off now. Tough day for Hank Parker Jr. Only one caution so far at lap 24. Kevin Harvick getting turned around coming off turn number four. And now these five cars have gained some distance on the 13 car pack behind them.
Four Pontiacs and that one lone Ford of Jeff Green. And behind them, a while ago, it was Kenny Wallace and Jeff Purvis with Kevin Grubb by themselves. Now they've got a group. They're single file. They're starting to catch this lead five.
And one of the things there that we alluded to earlier in the show was gear selection. When you've been out there by yourself qualifying, and you never know what these engines are going to turn until you get into the real draft like you're in the race situation with so many cars, and could have pulled the wrong gear and could be hurting some of these engines. What about it, Jeff? What do you think about that?
Darrell, right after Daytona, especially after Atlanta, I kind of did some research on this engine program. What is going on is everybody knows NASCAR came with a different combination for the Busch Series this year. A lot of the engine builders still have not quite figured out how heavy a rod, what type of piston they need to run. You're seeing this today when these engine failures. And the one point I'd like to add here is that these guys can't change engines like a Winston Cup car. So when they qualify, they get it hot, they may damage it, they get air during the course of the race, and these parts are starting to fail on them. So they're going through a learning curve of learning that you can't abuse these engines, you can't get them that hot. Today may be a perfect example of that.
Well, if you're Jimmy Spencer, you don't want to see this next graphic, because Jimmy Spencer is the leader. We've just crossed the halfway point. The halfway leader's never won this race.
Wow. Wow.
That's a surprise.
How about the guy running second? I wonder how many times he's won it.
55 laps to go in the Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready. Jimmy Spencer leading Joe Nemechek, McLaughlin, Todd Bodine, Jeff Green, and Kenny Wallace. We'll be right back. NASCAR on Fox has the Subway 300 from Talladega Super Speedway presented by Labor Ready. For you today, Jimmy Spencer continues to hold the lead at 61 laps, trying to become the eighth different winner this season. What is the record for most different winners in a Busch Series season is today's Pep Boys trivia question.
Can we guess?
Well, of course.
12.
14.
Happened twice, 1988 and 1989. And the answer is 18 different winners.
Wow.
18. Oh. 18 different winners. Couple interested onlookers next door in the NASCAR booth. Good to see Bill France Jr., the chairman of NASCAR, here. And Rusty Wallace is bending his ear.
Yeah, I don't know what that's all about, but I don't think it's good.
Five cars have been able to hold a breakaway from the field, but sixth place Jeff Purvis is pulling that pack right up to them. It's not going to be just five cars for long.
But the one factor, in about 10 laps, everybody's going to be on pit road, and it's going to really be chopped up then, because we're about 10 laps away from these cars, 10 to 15 away from a green flag stop.
Well, then I guess it's time for you folks to exercise
coming
those speakers
outside,
and kind of turn things up here. So why don't you crank it up a bit and enjoy the sounds of NASCAR Busch Racing on Fox.
Strategy. Right now, if the caution should come out, they're in a window. They could make it to the end of the race. But Jeff Hammond, I'm thinking green right now. I'm making deals. I'm running up and down pit road. I got my spotters working. What I want to do, I want to get to pit road. There they are, making the deals. The deal makers are going. I want to get to pit road with not too many cars, but enough dancing partners, and I want me two more right side tires to make sure that thing's full of fuel.
Exactly, Larry. Way I calculated out, I was sitting there thinking that you could go probably around 50 laps, and that puts you about 75 laps as far as your pit stop's concerned. You were talking about stopping the next 10 or 15 laps, but trying to figure out, do you want to stop early? Who do you want to stop with? To me, I'd want to go as far as I could, see what everybody else does, and then try to come maybe with two or three of the best cars and make a quick stop, like you say, get two tires, and get down and get going.
How about it, Steve? Who's got the high car?
Let's find out from the crew chief, Tim Shutt, who works with Mike McLaughlin. Tim, I noticed you talking with Brian Patty, the crew chief on the 87. What is your pit strategy? When will you stop? What will you do?
Well, we'd probably like to stop with whoever's leading the race. I mean, the front two cars right now are probably the fastest two cars out there. So we've been able to work with those two cars better than anybody else today. So unless things change around a whole bunch, we'll probably just come in whenever they do.
All right, thanks, Tim. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
The car that Brian Patty, the crew chief for Joe Nemechek, has prepared is running in the second position. Brian, when do you plan on making your final stop?
Somewhere between 75 and 80. I'm not real sure who's going to come with us, but there's three or four guys that are good friends of mine, and we'll see if they're really good friends, you know. The one car looks really tough, and the 20, the 18, I mean, the same guys that were at Daytona are the same guys here. Running Buckshot's car is running good, but I mean, we'll see. Between 75 and 80, we'll see who's friends.
Two tires or gas and go?
To be determined.
To Dick Berggren.
Representatives of Jason Keller's team, Jeff Green's team, and Kenny Wallace's team have all been down here talking to Johnny Allen, crew chief for Jimmy Spencer, trying to cut a deal. Meanwhile, Mark Reno, his regular crew chief, is way up high. He is spotting. Allen and Reno have decided to bring him in after he takes the lap 77, after he crosses under the start-finish line on 77. He'll be in the next lap. May take two, may take none. That hasn't been decided yet.
But guys, the car that could dictate this strategy, remember the double zero, Todd Bodine. He was on pit road with everybody else around lap 23. His strategy, four tires and then two. He's going to be the one, I think, that dictates these guys take only two tires.
Yeah, the only thing I'd be worried about as a driver is don't get me run over. Don't get me run over when I come down pit lane. Get me in with everybody. Let everybody know when I'm coming.
All right, Randy LaJoy is back on track to fish for points. So is Matt Kenseth. We'll be back with more of the Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready when pit stops come up in a minute.
The Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready on Fox is brought to you by NBNA, issuer of the official NASCAR credit card. Log on, NBNA.com.
Welcome back to Talladega, where we expect pit stops within 5 to 10 laps if this race stays green. Brad Baker is in a little bit early.
And he really just dove off the racetrack right down in front of oncoming traffic. These guys right here, they have been racing mighty, mighty hard and mighty, mighty close.
Yeah, look at the wrinkles on Ashton Lewis's rear quarter pin.
There's why. Bam.
Oh, there's another one.
Yeah.
Already had one. Now he's got a couple.
Give me a little more room here, bud, and if you don't, I'm going to have to push you out of my way.
Contact with Andy Kirby in that black car.
I guess you would call that at Talladega casual contact. No harm, no foul. Maybe a little temper flaring, but that's not unusual for here either.
Temper and fender.
Temper.
Flaring, yeah.
Temper.
Jimmy Spencer continues to pull the train. Joe Nemechek has him right in his gun sights. And now McLaughlin looks inside, running a little lower there. And here comes Kevin Harvick, our point leader, back.
He's in 41st. There's a couple other cars that's out of the race. Again, any position he can make up is just a few more points that will mean a difference at the end of the year.
He'll need to gain about 32 laps. He'll need to run about 32 laps to gain at least a position. Greg Biffle is poised to take over the point lead from Harvick.
But with that said, that's still what you've got to do. If you can't gain anything, you've got to fix the car. You got to go back out on the racetrack. You never want your team to get used to the fact that if something happens to the car, you're going to park it.
David Starr is also back after further repairs to that hood hinge on the left side of his hood. Show you Brad Baker's entrance to the pit.
Yeah, he was up against the outside wall. Watch him, and he just turns down in front of Shauna.
Shauna, whoa.
That is all the wrong way to come to pit road.
Fortunately, she was on her game that time.
I mean, the crew chief now, we're just a few laps away from pit stops. Now what you're doing, you're telling that driver, look, this will probably be our last pit stop. Get on the pit road good, don't speed, come to your sign, you get that crew together. Guys, this is our final pit stop. No mistakes, no mistakes. All the lugs on, all the lugs tight.
One of the biggest things that I fear, though, when I bring it up again, is somebody running into somebody as they all try to get down on the pit lane. They got those little brakes on the things, they're cold, they haven't been using them. And all of a sudden you holler pit and you got to whoa that thing down from 190 mile an hour to 55.
And that's the thing, you don't realize 55 miles an hour, it sneaks up on you so fast.
It's kind of like coming off the interstate when you've been running 75 or 80 onto a little off ramp that says 35 mile an hour, and you don't realize how fast you're going until you do that.
Yeah, your whole depth perception changes with speed. And so that's a tough thing to do. I thought he was a little kiddie-wombus yeah. Coming off pit road, and it seems he is a lot.
That's a sidewinder there.
Yep.
But considering how hard he hit that outside retaining wall with the back of that car, just to get it back out there and rolling is quite of an accomplishment.
It's going to be so important that they get that thing where it'll go at least maintain a certain speed, because NASCAR will not let them just ride around out there.
No, you got to have a minimum speed or you can't stay on the racetrack.
All right, pit stops within six laps. Now, the first six cars have now been able to get a pretty good breakaway going on that next pack.
And this is when, as crew chiefs, you get together with these guys and you say, look, what are you going to do? It makes no sense for one of these cars to do two tires, one of them to do four tires. You want to stay in sync with each other.
It's 3 seconds, Larry, from the first pack to the second pack here, with a lot of side-by-side racing still going on there.
And I got to believe it's time to hit pit lane, boys. I mean, we're coming up on 75 laps, and I don't think these things can go much further.
We could have the fastest Busch Series race ever. There's only been one caution flag today. Mark Martin won at Talladega with one caution in 1997. Average speed 168.9, second only to the August 95 Michigan race. 169.5 is the record. 65 was slow down the back straightaway, Bobby Gerhardt.
I believe he ran out of fuel over off the turn two. I saw him slow way down and drop to the inside. Seems like he's coasting back to the pits. Just don't want to speed down pit lane, buddy. Add insult to injury.
And Gerhardt makes pit road. Pit stops anytime now.
Anytime now. And again, I got to believe you'll see these four, five, six cars here hit pit road together, Jeff.
Double checking the math now, Larry. I see a lot of these guys stopping like 26, lap 26, make their pit stop. Fuel windows could have been as far as lap 55 laps, which would bring it to 81 laps. 81 laps, they could go. Gene, what do you got going on?
Well, guys, it's just right side tires only for the 60 car of Greg Biffle, who, by the way, is not having any fun, he said over the radio. Even though he started 31st and he's now 8th and moving, but, you know, not swapping paint, he's not trying. Fuel and he's on his way.
Is Jimmy Spencer out of fuel?
Well, you know what? Last week I remember Bobby Hamilton say that car had a pickup problem at Nashville and it ran out of gas at Nashville.
Dick?
They're not sure if he's out of fuel or not. Spencer just radioed to his crew, I'm not sure what's going on, but they just sprang into action as if in fact he was. They do think he is out of gas.
Kevin Grubb's been in, Jimmy Johnson has been in, Jamie McMurray, Tim Fedewa, Shauna Robinson have all made pit stops.
And if he's out of fuel, his motor's not running, and the only speedometer he has for pit road speed is a tachometer. The motor has to be running to maintain that.
And you have to be so careful, but he did run out in a good place. I mean, he has made it back to pit road.
But he's still going to lose a lot of time if, for fact, he is out of fuel.
You hear the engine quiet as he comes to a stop. Dick?
He did get the engine refired for a little bit. And coming down the pit road, Spencer told his crew that it is idling a little bit. It did fire, then it quit again. They've got the tires changed, but the engine is silent. Pouring the ether into the cockpit, into the cowl. It won't go. They're trying to push him. The Mark Greeno's hollering, push him to the crew. And the crew has only got three men pushing. There's the fourth. Not quite enough speed. Finally, Spencer gets going.
The same thing happened to that car at Nashville last week. Ran out of fuel with Bobby Hamilton driving it.
All our leaders are on pit road. That's what you could not do, is have that kind of mistake.
Nemechek leads them down. McLaughlin, Green, Purvis, all in. Steve.
Mike McLaughlin's going to take right side tires. Crew chief Tim Shutt, Jay Ganari on the right sides. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
Steve, a two-tire stop for the 87 car of Joe Nemechek.
losing a number of positions.
Pushing Marty Houston down pit road, his car apparently out of fuel.
Looks like Nemechek had a problem on the right front there, something that took a little bit longer than it should have.
Tim Sauter in, Jason Keller completes his stop. Rich Bickle is in.
That two car went by, he'll wear out his rear tires. He's running so sideways.
Yeah, coming to pit road at this lap, these guys needed one full can of fuel and probably about a fourth to a half a can of the next can. They didn't need to sit there till the thing was completely full.
Well, Marty Houston's going to need more than that, Larry. Get a little can of ether from further down pit road, see if they can get him fired up. Meanwhile, more deal making going on, as we've had what may be the final pit stop today in the Subway 300, presented by Labor Ready on Fox. The second caution of the day is out. There is the result. Joe Nemechek, after his pit stop, had problems going into turn number one.
Yeah, I just looked over and saw him. Smoke started flying out of the car and started bottoming out on the right side, and up the track he went. And he didn't hit the wall real, real hard, but as you can see, he tore the whole sheet metal off the side of the car.
Darrell, he did a great job of keeping that car under control, and, yeah, and just kind of, it was a very light hit.
I think it must have gotten down on the inner liner and still gave him enough control that he didn't just slam into the wall.
And there's a look at Nemechek after the contact with the outside wall.
I wasn't so sure that he wasn't going to be able to chase it up there and not hit the wall, but going a little too fast for that to happen. A lot of that damage is being done by the tire itself.
Matt?
Considerable damage to the 87 car, Mike. He came on the radio and said he felt like something, maybe might have with a shock blown away, cut down the sidewall, blew out the whole side. As you can see, the whole right side of the car. What they're going to do, they're going to try to assess the damage, and if all possible, put right side tires on, go back out, come back in again, and make some more repairs. But boy, a tough break for this 87 car. A lot of guys picked him to be the car to beat here, especially after happy hour when he pulled out by himself and blew past the entire pack. Now he shuts it off. Boy, tough break for Brian Patty and his Sailor One Lead crew.
Yeah, there's no question he had the fastest car here. I think he was riding along behind Jimmy Spencer and just kind of biding his time, if you will. And now we've got this.
Darrell, looked as the car came off the wall, as we saw it going around slowly, like the right front was really towed out on it. And since Nemechek is not running for Busch Series points, if they fall off the lead lap, not much sense in continuing.
No, not really. And as they dropped that jack, I did notice that the right front bounced up and down as if the shock absorber was torn off as well. Mm.
That was our new leader of the race right now under caution, Chad Little in the 74 car.
Hey, former winner of this race in 1995.
Four cars that had not yet pitted included Chad Little, Tony Raines, Ashton Lewis, and Linda Namick. Dick?
Well, Jeff Purvis is going to have to re-pit. The problem with the last stop was one of miscommunication. The jack was dropped before they got all the fuel in it. And Doug Richard, when that caution flag came out, just keyed his radio and said to his driver, Jeff Purvis, we just got the break of our lives. Spencer also will be coming in. He's going to put four tires on that number one car.
Now, Jimmy Spencer is still on the lead lap. In fact, 22 cars are on the lead lap here.
Jeff Purvis did what he was supposed to do. He went when the jack dropped. When you're doing two tires, it's on the jack man's shoulders not to drop the car till the catch can man signals it's full, Dick Bergeron.
Well, yeah, he did the right thing, but what happened was when the jack dropped, there was a miscommunication about whether it was to be a four-tire change or a two-tire change. So jack drops, Purvis leaves, and that's exactly what happened. And right now, Purvis, the 18, and the one of Spencer are both in. They had previously hooked up, made a team out of things. They're both going to be restarting toward the back of the pack. Both with fast cars capable of winning, and we've got enough laps to go that something good could happen to either of those. Spencer still on pit road with a stop of a little over 18 seconds.
And that's got to be, those two guys have got to be the luckiest guys out there. One of them runs out of gas and doesn't get enough in the tank to make it to the end. Catch a caution.
And there's Joe Nemechek.
There's the unluckiest guy out there.
And the clock turns back to zero for 25 cars that are on the lead lap here at Talladega. We'll visit with Joe in a moment. We'll be right back to Talladega on Fox.
The Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready on Fox is brought to you by Subway, showing the world how great a fresh sandwich can taste. Subway, eat fresh. By Ralston Purina Company of Checkerboard Square. By Fram, pay a little more now or pay a lot later. And by Labor Ready, dependable temporary labor guaranteed.
Welcome back to Talladega, where the crowd, huge crowd here, enjoying this Busch Series race. Second caution of the day. Everybody's taking a pit stop, and we're going to take a quick one so that we can come back for the restart of the Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready.
Emma, the Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready. We are under caution, lap 84. Mike McLaughlin, our leader for the moment from Waterloo, New York. Speaking of Waterloo, Joe Nemechek, who had run very well here on lap 81, had a scrape with the wall, and that became his Waterloo. Let's check in with Matt Yocum. He's standing by with Joe.
And Chris, Joe Nemechek has climbed from his 87 car. Joe, what happened in the right front?
I'm not real sure. You know, we just stopped and got tires, and it started bouncing right before I got into turn one, and I think we must have broke a shock mount or a shock or an eyelet or something broke, and then it poked a hole in the side of the tire, and up the track it went, and it just barely hit the wall. But when the tire exploded, it blew the whole side off the car, and it kind of scared me when it exploded. But I was in perfect position. Randy LaJoy was behind me. He's going to give me a push back to the front. Our Cellular One Nortel Networks Pontiac, I think, was the best one here today, but we just didn't quite finish the job.
It certainly was fast. To Jeannie.
Well, Matt, green flag pit stop for Greg Biffle, so why waste the time, right? He just took the right side tires. He was thinking conservation, but he might have saved more than time. Check out this tire here. This is the right rear. As soon as they saw the staple in here, a lot of the crew hanging out here said, you know, we just won't tell the driver. Steve?
Jeannie, when Todd Bodine pitted on lap 77, he actually ran out of gas as he was coming off the racetrack, lost a few positions in the pits because they had to spray ether in that double zero to get it refired.
Thanks, Steve. Getting set for the restart. None of the top five drivers even started in the top 10. McLaughlin, Jeff Green, Greg Biffle, Kenny Wallace, Kevin Grubb. How about Biffle up to third after starting 31st?
That's just what makes Talladega so exciting. You just never know. You never know who's going to end up in the front at the end of the day.
McLaughlin downstairs.
And Mike, you don't even know when they come off turn four who's going to end up in the front at the end of the day.
Riding with Kenny Wallace, the Briggs & Stratton on board. That's Greg Biffle just ahead.
When you see what kind of ride he's getting, look at those arms and hands fighting that steering wheel, car bouncing around. That's just from the tires hopping through those ruts on the racetrack.
Let's update on Kenny. Even though he did not make the Winston Cup race, missed it by a hundredth of a second for tomorrow, the one race sponsorship that they got from Subway will be in the race on the Jeff Purvis car, so they'll get some benefit from that. Well, how about all the deals being made along pit road, Jeannie?
Well, you don't go from 31st to 3rd without a little fight in you guys. Just listen to the radio here. And Greg Biffle's team just got a call from the 10 crew, and they said, hey, we want to make a deal with you. Biffle's people responded, yeah, we'll deal with you. We'll work with you after we get past the checkered flag. Thanks, but no thanks.
Well.
Well, we got us a whole new show here, if you will, because there's a bunch of people back here that haven't been near the front all day, and now they got a chance to get up there and race for the lead. Probably, oh, here we go, here we go.
One car at the bottom and two up top.
This is the big one.
Oh, there's cars everywhere.
That's the big one.
Not a question of if, but when.
When they get bunched up, particularly on restarts, buddy, you just never know what's going to happen.
You see 92, Jimmy Johnson, the 11. Here's Kenny Wallace and Biffle. They made it through. Marty Houston, who had gotten back on track up there.
You're looking at it the right way, Mike. Just look down here in turn one and see who's left.
Yes.
Because most of the other guys are laying up here in the corner.
David Green, there's Johnson. There is David Donahue in the 25. I see the 65, Bobby Gerhardt, the 16. That's David Starr. All involved in that wreck.
We had 22 cars on the lead lap. This crash has taken it to about 14 on the lead lap.
Rich Bickle got some damage, minor damage. He continues. And look at the litter inside turn four. Our first thoughts go to the drivers and our hopes that everyone is okay.
This car, I believe this car started everything. He appeared to come off of the apron. It looks like that car had a lot of damage, been hit a number of times.
It's Marty Houston. He's up on the high side of the racetrack. No, it was another blue car, oh, girl.
Yeah, it's
looked like possibly Tim Fito got to the back of the blue car right there. That's David Green, I believe, in the 34 car.
That it is. 34 was the first to go around. And look at the mess that ensues behind him.
And again, Darrell, like you said, this it normally happens after a restart when they're all bunched back up.
Everybody sees an opportunity, and they go for it.
There are at least 13 cars involved.
Oh, yeah, the Fedewa.
Tim Fedewa getting into the back of David Green.
Fedewa had a bad weekend last weekend with some contact with several cars, and again today.
And these guys are teammates, Fedewa and David Green.
Darrell, Larry, look at the 34 and look at the left rear tire. It looked like something happened on the left rear tire. It looked like something may have come out from underneath it just as he started around. See right there?
There it is.
Yeah,
it
see
is.
See right there?
It is.
That wouldn't have been from the contact.
No.
Something
no.
happened to the left rear tire.
No, I'm glad for Fedewa's sake because I know he felt bad about last weekend, and he sure didn't need to be involved in something like this.
It's like because of possibly the left rear tire coming apart, David Green's speed just slowed down, and Fedewa just got in the back of him.
Now Larry, I'd also wonder how right far there. Did he go on his left side tires? Did he put on two?
There's Donahue caught up in it. Jimmy Johnson, the 92. Hamilton with
gets
damage.
A little damage.
Just looking out of Bobby Hamilton Jr. He got a little bit of damage right there on the left here, but considering where he was, that was minimum.
At 27, Jamie McMurray on the right to the accident list.
Well, when Fedewa moved up, Donahue had to go up. That put him into the 11 car.
Add the 77, Mike Harmon.
We saw Mike Skinner in a 21 car all the way down, two lanes below the apron.
Minor damage to Hamilton, Biffle, and Jay Sauter. Drivers walking away. We'll take a break, come back and recap this. Give us a chance to check and make sure that everyone is okay. Add the 67 of Skip Smith to the accident toll. We'll be right back. Nine laps complete in the Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready on Fox. A quick rundown of the cars involved. There is David Donahue's going out of the race on a rollback, and that car, no matter who's in it, has been snake bit. There's David Green, the car that initiated the crash. Jimmy Johnson's car going up on the hook. We have David Starr involved. That's Jay Sauter is, or rather Tim Sauter, one of
McMurray.
Four cars involved that were able to continue. This one, of course, Jamie McMurray's could not. Now, Bobby Hamilton Jr. has damage and continued. So did Andy Kirby and Rich Bickle. Other cars involved include the 67 of Skip Smith, 77 Mike Harmon, 65 Bobby Gerhart, the 11 of Marty Houston. There's the 77, or rather what's left of it. And the 16 of David Starr were all involved in that crash coming into turn three. Let's have another look and show you what really caused all this.
Yeah, but first look, you know, their cars are right up here. And at first look, it looked like that maybe Fedewa had gotten into the back of David Green. But then on further review, watch the car. See that rubber tire roll out from under there, the tread off the tire? I don't believe Fedewa ever even touched David Green.
And I think this picture will tell the story.
So look way at the left corner of your screen.
There's Fedewa
right there. Looks real close, but the tire comes apart. Car starts to go around. Fedewa
no
actually does a pretty good job. It forces the 25 into the 11, but he made no contact with the 34.
Thanks to all our good camera work, we was able to prove that Tim Fedewa did not get in the back of his teammate.
He'll be a happy camper.
And a really tough break for David Donahue, who got bumped by Fedewa up into the 11 of Marty Houston, and everything went haywire from there. Jeannie?
Well, we caught up with David Green. First and foremost, how are you doing?
Got hurt. But all my sense and safety stuff did its job, and I feel fine. Car's tore up pretty bad. Yeah, I thank Aquaviva, AFG, all of our sponsors. Gonna be a decent day, but I don't know what happened right there, but sure got turned around and all hell broke loose, but I'm okay. root for my brother Jeff. Hopefully he'll do all right. But I got to thank my sponsors. Brand new sponsor on board this weekend, Aqua Velva. And all the support AFG's done with those folks and continue out throughout the year. It's awful exciting, but this is tough. I hate this. Two years in a row here at Talladega.
Good to hear you're doing okay, though. We do have a question. Just watching some of the tape, we saw a tire floating around out there. So a question of if you ever worked or changed on any of those left side tires in this race.
You know, we made a pit stop right there. We had to pit early for gas, and that really hurt us right there. And we were the tail end of the lead lap, and we made a stop, and we changed four Goodyears. So, you know, the car had been loose all day, and then right there it was extremely loose. But I thought I got hit in the back right there. But, hey, if a tire come off, maybe that's what happened. All I know is it turned around, and, well, I got hit a ton. Felt like a ping pong ball. But, again, got to thank my sponsors, and I'm okay. So go back. Go to California.
Bottom line, you're doing okay. Thank you. Mike?
Thanks.
Well, Jeannie, that car will not be going to California. Well, here's the hit list from Talladega of the cars involved in that crash as they work on Bobby Hamilton Jr.'s. All of these cars, in numerical order, were involved in some way. At least four of them have been able to continue.
16 cars, a third of the field.
That's why we call it the big one. Cleaning up this caution, the third of the day. Coming off turn number four, and we'll be back to the fastest speedway on Earth right after this word. You're watching NASCAR on Fox.
Fox welcomes you back to the Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready. We are currently under caution. Mike McLaughlin is your leader. The third caution flag of the day. A spectacular 16-car crash here. Let's check on someone involved in that with our Jeannie Zelasko. Jeannie?
Yes, Chris, here with Marty Houston, who said this is the first time you ever had the breath completely knocked out of you, but the good news is it's back and there are no broken ribs. You're doing okay, yes?
Yeah, after a few minutes, I got my breath back. Just a massive wreck. You know, you worry about that at Talladega, and it's something that's on your mind. And, you know, sure enough, there it was. I think from what we're hearing, David had a problem with the tire, and I never saw it come and never saw it start. Just got pinched up in the wall. Up to that point, you know, we were pretty happy. Channel Lock Chevy was running good. We tried to stretch our fuel mileage as far as we could, and we came down, and the guys on Channel Lock crew did a good job on the stop, but we had a carburetor problem, couldn't get the car back going, so we went a few laps down, and from that point, pretty much trying to avoid what happened and get a good day for Channel Lock, but, you know, that's Talladega. I've always said I enjoyed this place, and I've always said I've never been in one of the big wrecks, and now I've been in one of the big wrecks, so I'll let you know.
Yeah, and you have the memento of some strap bruises, but you're doing okay. Dick Berggren?
Yeah. Jimmy Johnson's car is behind us right now, or at least what's left of a car. The nose of that thing is all torn off. Radiator is out of it. Jimmy, you okay?
Yeah, that hurt. That's amazing. You don't realize how fast you're going. You kind of lull yourself into a daze. And got hit four or five times, and it looked like Fedewa turned a blue car. I don't know who it was, but turned him around, and it was all over from then. I'd run over from behind. But real shame. We started 29th. We're coming up through the pack. I thank everybody back at the shop and everybody here behind me. I think they're bored. I don't think this car's going to make it back on the track, but they're going to try to get it together so we can get out and get going. So I'll just take a few Excedrin tonight, and I'll be all right.
All right, we're glad you're okay. To Chris Myers.
All right, thank you very much. With Jeff Hammond, let's do a little speculating here because 22 cars were on the lead lap. Now a third of the field pretty much wiped out. The tire, something like that you just have to be ready for. You can't predict something like that. What do you think happened?
Chris, it's kind of it's premature to make an assumption on this, but it looked to me like maybe the tread is bonded to the carcass of the tire, and it appeared that there has a separation right there from the tire itself. The tread area came off. That could have been caused because of it ran over something and air was going out of it. It separated that quick because you got to realize you run 190 miles an hour and it can happen instantly.
Well, I'm sure a number of the drivers want to know exactly what happened. Also, you know, it's interesting. A number of them said that they were really kind of thrown around a little bit. And David Green mentioning that his Simpson safety gear did what it was supposed to. And at this point, no word of any serious injury. So what about getting back into the race? Those that can and those that survived that spill, what's their approach the rest of the way?
Well, I'm sure they'll be worried about it, but at the same time, you've really got to kind of shake it off. You've got to realize, hey, there's a few less cars that have to be messing with out there, but you still got to figure out how to get around the guy in front of you. Or if you're leading the race, You got to figure out how to keep them behind you.
Yeah, now for someone like David Green, and earlier we saw even Joe Nemechek, who was out before this, where he said he thought he had the best car in this race. Does this, and maybe, you know, we hear about the big one so often. We talked about the Talladega 500 race on Sunday, Jeff, the anticipation of either being out in front or laying back and trying to avoid in the different packs. What did you see in this particular instance that worked or didn't work for those drivers?
The first thing I saw is what happened couldn't have been avoided. There was nothing David Green could have done about it. The 66 car, he had no choice. He had to try to get above him to keep him running the back of him. This is what happens when you have such good competition going this fast. Anything can happen, and when it does, it's usually catastrophic, and it's huge.
All right, let's check back down on the pit area with our Jeannie Zelasco as we got a look at some of the cars being worked on. Jeannie?
Cars being worked on some of the drivers as well, but the good news for David Starr, the Hans device worked very well, yes?
Yeah, the Hans device was great. That was the first time we really got to use it. You know, you wear the Hans device and never really had a chance, and that was the first time. I'll tell you what, I live by the Hans device. It really worked real good for us. We had a good run at the start of the race, and the hood started to come off. The hood brace broke, and we had to come in for a pit stop to nail the hood back down. We pop-rooted it down, and we got behind two or three laps, and we're just trying to go to the end, and it's unfortunate that our 31W installation Pontiac didn't make it to the end. We're just trying to make a bad day and to bring it home in one piece, and that's not going to be today.
On the tape, we could see a tire out there. Could you see anything?
You know, what I could see was David Green. I didn't know if another car got into David Green or he lost a tire. Somebody said his tire came off the rim, but all I could see is car got sideways, and I checked up. Somebody hit me from behind, and I was just a ping pong ball bouncing off all the other cars. But it's a fun place to race. I mean, it's great racing. It's just when that happens, you see what happens. It collects a lot of cars, but, you know, if we could just avoid the big wreck, the fans would have seen a great race, and there's still going to be a good race out there. Just hopefully everybody finishes in one piece.
And most important, you are. Go rest, Matt.
Well, Bobby Hamilton Jr. in the 26 car has returned to the racetrack after his third stop on pit road. His crew hop riveted a new front fascia on that number 26 car, trying to fix the left front damage. A lot of tape on the front, trying to seal up all the body areas here to make this car as aerodynamic as possible. But a tough break for this number 26 team.
Thanks, Matt. NASCAR confirms that all of the drivers involved in that accident are okay, that there are no injuries. That is certainly good news to pass along. There are our leaders, Mike McLaughlin and Jeff Green. Now, the driver that Tim Fedewa ended up bumping into Marty Houston and into the wall is out of the race and with Jeannie.
Yeah, David Donahue, take us through your perspective of what happened. You were just sent flying.
Yeah, I was the middle guy, three wide, and Tim just got up into me, and when I had to move up because he moved me up a lane, there was already a car on my outside and just turned me up to the wall. And it's real unfortunate for Team Marines because it's two for two. You know, we crashed in Nashville with Tim and now here with Tim, so we'll be back at Fontana. We'll never give up, but, you know, Team Renzi motors on.
And you're doing okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. It was a pretty hard hit, but I wore the Hans device like a lot of these guys do nowadays, and we're all right.
All right, take the rest of the day off. Go relax. Thanks for the time. Thank guys. You.
That face looked familiar. David's dad was Mark Donahue, Indy 500 champ and a NASCAR Winston Cup winner. Tomorrow on the Fox family of networks, wall-to-wall NASCAR. Mike Skinner's in the driver's spotlight on NASCAR this morning at 10 a.m. Eastern on Fox Sports Net. Then our Talladega 500 presented by Subway at 12:30 Eastern time on Fox. And NASCAR Victory Lane to wrap it all up on the net at 9 p.m. your local time. We'll be right back. Getting set to restart the Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready. Jeannie?
Well, Shane Hull, one of the guys at the back of the pack who was unable to squeeze through. What was your spotter saying? Was there any communication when you saw it happen in front of you?
Believe it or not, I think it happened so quick we didn't even get a response, and I was just trying to ease through there. It just something happened up in front of the Lance Snatch car, and just didn't have a whole lot of time to react. We thought we had a way through it, trying to stay straight. Somebody got us from behind, turned us around, but it's probably the same story these other 12 guys have said too. So just hopefully get things together and go to California and try to turn our deal around. We've been having way too much of this kind of luck here the last couple of weeks. So.
Good ending for everybody, though. You're all walking away. Guys?
Getting set for the restart, Jeannie. Mike McLaughlin leads Jeff Green, Craig Biffle, Mike Wallace, Kevin Grubb, Todd Bodine, Jason Keller, Elton Sawyer, Jeff Purvis, and Jay Sauter, the top 10. Mike Skinner, Jimmy Spencer, Chad Little, Larry Foyt, Tony Raines, Andy Kirby, Rich Bickle, Bobby Hamilton Jr., and Jay Sauter are the lead lap cars as we go back to green.
And that was just a little wake-up call there, folks. You might want out and run out and get old Jesse and wake him up and get him back in the house, because this thing ain't over with yet.
All right, Bobby Hamilton Jr., he's still on the lead lap after all of his problems. In 19th, we've got a report he only has first and fourth gear. It's going to take him about 2 to 3 laps to even get up to speed, but the rest of the pack's going to be long gone.
But he may still get a lead lap finish out of this, clear, even though he's well back of the pack.
Well, he's got a lot of damage on the front end, and they did a pretty good job of repairing it, but he's certainly not a factor as far as winning this race. He's just trying to survive it now.
Remember when Randy LaJoie came out of the garage and so did Kevin Harvick? Harvick can gain one spot, but LaJoie could pick up 12 positions before the end of this after the results of that melee. Second place car is Jeff Green. Steve's in his pit.
Mike with crew chief Harold Holly. Harold, we talked about you put a backup motor in there. Are you and Jeff Green confident you can get to the front with that backup motor?
Well, I tell you, it's whoever's working with you at the end. The motors just run awesome all day. The Roush guys have done a super job with our engines, and we've hardly had zero failures in 2 years, so we got a lot of confidence in those guys. And Jeff's doing an awesome job in the Nesquik Taurus today, so we'll just have to see what happens here at the end.
Now, they've said that car is better behind someone than in front.
I've been watching that car, and I keep thinking the same thing, what they told me this morning. This car has to have help. Look at here, 4, 5 wide. These guys know there's only 16 laps to go. Look at them touching.
Jimmy Spencer, and that's one of the most treacherous places on the racetrack. It's when you drop those left wheels down on the apron to the tri-oval. We've seen some bad accidents occur because of that.
Daryl, who rang the bell? This is not the last lap, but it looks like it.
It is for Jimmy Spencer. Every lap's the last lap for him. He's got to get
it. That's Jason Keller, 57 car. Something was going on with that car. Christian Elder, nowhere to go into 38. Something was going wrong with Jason Keller. He dropped to the apron, shot back up the racetrack.
Fourth caution of the day at lap 97 as Keller's car rolls helplessly into the wall and to a stop.
How unfortunate. Great run last week. Same thing for Christian Elder there, his car.
And both the point leaders come to grief here in Talladega. Now trying to get back to the flag, and there's contact between Biffle and the car up on the high side. That is Mike Skinner as they come to the flag.
These guys do race back to the caution flag this close to the end of the race. Any position you can get is going to help you on the restart.
There's Jason Keller. He is okay.
See if we can see what happened in this case here. He's right around the bottom of the racetrack. He drops down on the apron. Oh, when he dropped down on the apron, I believe he may have been going. I think he might have been trying to get out of the way. I think he felt something wrong, and when he got down on the apron, the car just took off with him.
Daryl, from 36 degrees, that apron's not quite flat, but isn't that a pretty serious transition?
Yeah, you can't drive down there. I mean, you can come up to speed down there, but you sure can't get down there when you're up to speed. He's wobbling a little bit back. You see a touch of smoke. I believe he had something go wrong with that car.
Dick, what was the problem?
Well, the crew says it was a tire. Ironically enough, he had been running at the finish of 36 straight races, just like Kevin Harvick, all the way back to year 2000 Atlanta. So I'm sure they're going to work hard on this thing and try to get it back out. But it's going to be a lot of work to do that and not much time in which to do it.
And the innocent victim, hard on the brakes, Christian Elder, going high to get around Keller and just runs out of room. Keller comes right up into him.
Yeah, he couldn't do anything. Backed right up in front of him. But you see that 57 car, Keller's car, starts to wiggle just a little bit. He felt it. He tried to get down out of the way, and when he did, he got down on the apron. He was going fast, and the car just shot back up on the racetrack.
And Daryl, you just can't carry much speed down on an apron. Plus, the apron's very dirty. A lot of trash there.
Yeah, and if he had, in fact, had a problem with his left rear tire, I mean, that's just like going down there and spinning the thing out.
And though we did not see it, Christian Elder did climb out of his race car, and there he is. He is okay. Again, very good news. Fourth caution of the day as they come past start finish, and you see them discussing the run to the flag position, which NASCAR scoring will sort out and adjust. And Biffle and
Biffle not real happy with Spencer.
No, nope.
This looks like,
or with Skinner, they got together. They got together coming down for the caution flag.
But NASCAR has a camera at the start finish line. They can go back on any given lap and they can tell you exactly who crossed it, and they'll sort it out through the crew chiefs and tell them where you need to line up on the restart.
And they have the scoring transponders that indicate the exact instant to the thousandth of a second as they come across the line.
And there's a gentleman's agreement that, you know, if you're in the lead there, in the lead pack particularly, you don't necessarily have to race back, and normally you don't. But we're running out of time here, and this track is hard to pass on. So guys are going to take advantage, and I think Biffle probably feels like, as a rookie, he got taken advantage of.
Trying to pick up Jason Keller's car. Katie McLaughlin, Mike McLaughlin's wife.
Gotta go, you gotta go.
A bundle of nerves, and who can blame her? Her husband leads this race. It's the second time this season. He led two laps at Nashville last week, and his best Talladega finish, third, 3 years ago.
Finished sixth at Daytona.
We will be back for the restart and conclusion of the Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready on Fox. Cards have been shuffled and redealt here at Talladega Super Speedway, the world's fastest racetrack, with this fourth caution flag of the day. Rick Biffle's car owner, Jack Roush, who turns 59. And deals being made up and down pit road now that the restart positions have been aligned. McLaughlin, Green, Spencer, Skinner, Biffle, Purvis, and Elton Sawyer. There's that 98. We've not seen much of Elton today, and he's fought his way up into the top 10. Big crowd for the Busch race. The front straightaway grandstand quite full, and it's going to be packed here tomorrow. Now, coming up on the Fox family of networks, the next three races in NASCAR's Busch Series. Next Saturday, we'll be out at Fontana, California on the Super Speedway. On Fox, at Richmond, Virginia, a night race on FX, and then Mother's Day weekend, Saturday, Loudoun, New Hampshire, on FX. Well, let's go down to the Hollywood Hammond Hotel and see what's cooking.
Well, we're just trying to keep an eye on things. Again, thankfully, repeating, after that spectacular crash involving 16 cars, no serious injury, NASCAR releasing that information. Then the recent spill with Jason Keller, everybody seems okay. But you're keeping an eye on Chad Little, who started way back. And as you pointed out to us before, races here at Talladega, you can start way back and have a chance of pulling it out. He's come a long way. Hasn't won since 1995.
No, but he has a knack for getting around this place for some reason. He started back in 42nd position. He's now up to 11th position. He has led this race, as a matter of fact. Just prior to the big wreck, he wound up being the leader. But I noticed the last couple of times he hasn't come up to speed like he needed to. I'm wondering if he's got a little bit of a problem. But after he gets her going, he's coming toward the front. So he still may be a factor, even though he's 11th position.
All right, and of course, Mike McLaughlin, your leader. Jeff Green, we pointed out at the beginning that his engine blew last in qualifying, and of course fired up his engine and has run well here and come back from 12th. He's in the hunt. He will officially start with Richard Childress running in the Winston Cup, seven Winston Cup races this year, continuing obviously in the Busch Series. That starts next week in California.
At California, top-to-top barrier about a week ago, and he was preparing to go out there, and they've actually been testing out there with that team. So they should be on go when they arrive in California. Okay. And Jeff Green is an excellent driver, racing for Richard Childress like that. It should be a golden opportunity for him and their new sponsor.
And Jeff Green again started fourth in points when the day began. Kevin Harvick, the points leader, out, has now come back into the race. But also Randy LaJoie, who was a top 10, ninth in points, had to lead the race. So there could be some shuffling here. This could be a terrific opportunity for Jeff Green. And Spencer is running third, Skinner fourth at the moment. Let's go up to the booth, Mike Joy.
Yeah, and Greg Biffle could leave here with the point lead the way things stand right this minute. 17 cars are on the lead lap, and they include three rookies. Greg Biffle, Tim Sauter, and the 14 of Larry Foyt.
Started 17th, but Darrell, theory holds true. Dodge the big one, stay out of trouble, stay on the lead lap, and you can be there at the end here at Talladega.
Get a good finish. Last week, this car was running good. He stayed on the lead lap right up to the very end, and he got hung up and caught up in a little wreck at the end of the day. But I think that kid's getting a little better every week. Got good equipment, got good people. I think he's learning these cars. Might see some good stuff out of that kid before it's over with.
Now, there are the series rookie of the year contenders. There's another rookie on the lead lap, and that's Andy Kirby, though he's not a rookie of the year contender.
And now, Jason damage.
Yep, Jason Keller was the car that brought out that last caution. Jeannie's with him.
Yeah, Jason, very difficult day for you and a tough ending. What happened here with that tire?
Just must have run over something on a racetrack. When you wreck that many race cars, it's hard to get everything clean, but just unfortunate for the Albertsons Ford.
looking pretty good there, and just battled our way back up to top 10 contention. And hoping those leaders get side by side, maybe I could pull something out. But can't do that in the pit area here. But it's a good day for us. We ran up front most of the day, and just didn't end that way.
We're just wondering if maybe there was some debris out there. Did you feel anything, and then did it drop down?
I never felt anything, and my spotter was really telling me when we were coming through the where they had the wreck here. You know, it was talking me through there, and I never felt like I hit anything, but it could have been so small, and I never gave any warning, just went down into one, actually, in blue, but hey, I'm okay, and that's the main thing.
That's most important. Thank you.
Well, that's the best news, is that of all of the crashes we've had today, every one of these drivers is going to be able to race in California next week.
And quite honestly, things like that do happen so quickly that sometimes the driver has to go home. I know I've done it myself and looked at a replay, watch it on TV, and then it comes to me, oh yeah, now I remember what was going on.
We're getting set for this restart. McLaughlin the leader. Jeff Green, who has only led one lap at Talladega in six Busch Series starts, is second. Katie McLaughlin.
I don't know.
Oh, my heart.
I don't know if she can make it 11 more laps.
I don't either.
We're going to have a double file restart. Again, you have to get into that 10 lap to go window before it's single file. Double file restart, 11 laps to go. Pull on your belts one more time, DW. It's going to get exciting. Hey,
and don't leave out Big Orange. Jimmy Spencer here, third. This is his fourth race in the number one car. 13th at Darlington. Engine trouble at Bristol and Texas.
Oh, I think he's the man to beat.
This restart's so important. Be smooth with those shifts. Hit every gear. Restart.
They're getting away from Spencer.
Yeah, he didn't get up to speed, and he's getting a little help from Skinner there to get him going.
The two lead cars got away, and McLaughlin and Green.
They've got lap cars in between them right there.
But let me tell you, when you get out front, you're just a sitting duck. They're just going to get a bigger run at you. That's all they're going to do.
Greg Biffle in the 60 car pulling down behind below Mike Skinner there in the 21. They're going to be four wide down the backstretch.
Well, that's good news for the leaders, but how will this shake out? Spencer coming along on the high side in third, closing up on the lead duo.
He's got the better of the three cars. Definitely better than Green, and I don't think McLaughlin can hold him off either.
Four wide behind them. Wow.
I mean, you're down inside of 10 laps to go. The race is on the line. You got to go.
For the lead, Mike Skinner trying to take it from Jeff Green. Up alongside of Spencer. And McLaughlin holds the point.
And Jeff Green's going to lose a position here, caught on the outside from these three guys right here. McLaughlin, Spencer, Skinner.
Green needs to get back in line as quick as he can, or he could really find himself in trouble here. Needs to drop down, get behind Skinner.
He does. And Greg Biffle comes right up with him. Can Katie McLaughlin last 10 more laps?
I'm sure if Mike was looking there, he'd say, honey, I thought you liked racing.
She does not like Daytona and Talladega. Mike has had some hard crashes at both these tracks. As nervous as she is, I can certainly understand that. Here comes Spencer.
And of course, these two guys have raced each other in the modifieds many times. Spencer's looking to the inside, but he can't quite make the pass.
He didn't have any help that time. Had to get back in line here, going off into turn one. Mike Skinner going to pull to the high side. He'll shoot to the bottom with the help of Jeff Green if he can get it.
Spencer comes up to block Skinner. This is like tic-tac for all the dough right here.
Yeah. Spencer's got a run on him this time, and of course McLaughlin.
Skinner,
is,
he's down. Spencer was in the infield.
Took him all the way almost to the grass, and Skinner's done that before. He knows that's not the right thing to do.
That's the reason they don't have grass back there anymore.
Right.
It didn't work.
McLaughlin on the inside by himself, back for the lead.
But Skinner's going to help. Well, no, Skinner doesn't know who to help.
Jeff Green's going to the bottom, though, with a 10 car. He's going to help McLaughlin. Spencer, they touch. They go right out of racetrack here.
They're out of racetrack.
He's down on the apron. Boy, that's a dangerous move to get down on the apron like that.
Trouble, one car's in the wall, in the tri-oval. Purvis spins across the field, and everybody gets through. Now,
these guys are racing up front. They're still racing back to the green, back to the caution flag.
The racetrack is clear now. I don't know if this will be for the race, but they want to race all the way back to the start-finish line to see that caution flag.
Mike McLaughlin has got a fast race car, guys. He has been able to hold Spencer off, and I didn't think he'd be able to.
Todd Bodine in the double zero. He's trying to get as many positions as he can here, three and four.
Bodine up for fourth. The first three are single file, but there's still a mile to go to the caution flag.
And this is what we hate about the start-finish line being way down here where it is. Watch this. You're going to have a real race on your hands just to get to the start-finish line.
Look Spencer. At Spencer on the apron. Skinner down to the bottom.
McLaughlin did what he had to do, and he holds on to the flag.
I got to tell you, that McLaughlin car is fast. He's got enough car there to win this race.
I'm with Katie. I can't stand it either.
Oh, boy.
There's seven laps to go. That's a long time under caution. It will probably get this race restarted.
Jeff Purvis is all right. He's put the window net down. That's a signal to rescue officials that he is okay. But what happened to the 18 car?
Looking at him as they come into the tri-oval here.
Oh.
Just come up kind of in front of Greg Biffle.
Come right across in front of Biffle, and they made a little contact.
Of course, Jeff Purvis, that's Mike McLaughlin's teammate. Both these guys drive for Joe Gibbs. Boy, lucky right there, nobody hit him.
That's called threading the needle right there. Just threading your way through there. Purvis is down on the bottom, and the cars, believe it or not, they're really difficult to drive right through that part of the tri-oval. Saw Ward Burton get down on that apron here a couple of years ago in a Winston Cup race and got into Dale Earnhardt and caused a big crash. That is a hard part of this racetrack.
You don't realize how much of a curve that tri-oval is till you got the angle that we're looking at it. It's quite a corner.
Oh, yeah, and then when you drop your wheels down on the apron, it just causes the car to slide back up on the racetrack.
I want whatever color chips are in Larry Foyt's pockets. Watch the purple car. He just, at the end of this, he just dodges another one. These cars are well out of harm's way. Here comes Foyt. Not yet, sorry. He's just going to sneak through there again. There he is.
Yeah, there he goes. Just
close call.
Wow.
All right, you're on board Jeff Purvis.
See the blurs going by, and that's cars.
I have woke up in the middle of the night to those sounds in a cold sweat. That and the tires crying.
And do you think it's ever going to end, Darryl?
I don't think it's ever going to go away.
We'll have at least two more laps of caution. As now Purvis's car is picked up and hauled away, which means we will get this race back under green.
Well, we really got to shoot out now.
Well, let's check up on the wheeling and dealing that still goes on. Matt?
Well, Mike, that wheeling and dealing actually started right before the last practice session yesterday afternoon. The one car of Jimmy Spencer and the 21 of Skinner worked for most of the session together, drafting, see who would be better in front or behind. Skinner's car was not quite as good as the one car of Spencer out front. In fact, about 2 minutes ago, Spencer was talking to his spotter and crew chief, Mark Reno, said, tell Skinner to get behind me. The 20 car of McLaughlin keeps taking me to the grass. I think we can get by him, but I'm going to need his help because I am better than Skinner's car out front.
Yeah, but the verb there is important. Tell versus ask.
Yeah.
Well, and the real deal is two or three laps to go. This is where deals are done. Get out of my pits. Go back to your pits. Driver, run your race. Watch your mirror. Do your deal. No more deals.
You've got what you got. We're going to get what we get. Chris Myers.
A terrific couple of moments here. Let's get a quick look back at what's going on here at the Subway 300 presented by Labor Ready. Jeff Hammond, let's take us through it. Kevin Harvick, our current points leader, coming in the Busch Series, has some problems early going here, hitting the wall. They try to repair the car.
Yeah, you can see right here they got the torches out. Will Lynn, Todd Barrier, all the AC Delco crew, they're trying to get the repairs made, which they did.
Randy LaJoy, who won the Busch race at Daytona, was black flagged because of an oil problem.
Yeah, NASCAR says, hey, guys, can't take it back out till you fix it, which they were able to. Jimmy Spencer ran out of gas running up toward the front, had to refire. Fortunately, called a caution.
And then Joe Nemechek, who led for a time, two-time winner in this race, scrapes the wall, creating problems. And then on lap 87, the loose tire from David Green causes major havoc.
Large wreck. You can see here from the 20 car right here. This right here is Mike McLaughlin, our leader right now, as he threads his way through this big wreck.
Fortunately, he got through. Now he's leading.
And again, no serious injuries after the restart. Lap 97, Jason Keller with problems. Christian Elder runs into him.
Yeah, it looked like...
Looks like a problem there. Both were okay. Then with eight laps to go, Jeff Purvis, teammate of Mike McLaughlin, the leader, he has problems wrecking, able to walk away from that without any serious injury as well. Mike McLaughlin, your leader, under the caution flag. Jimmy Spencer second, Mike Skinner third, and Jeff Green is currently running fourth. So we've had a lot of activity, and yes, we can hang around for a terrific finish here. Jeff, what should we expect here over these final few laps coming out of the caution?
Well, I know right now, if I'm sitting out there, I'm the crew chief. I'm telling my driver, pull in belts tight, spotter. Take you a couple deep breaths, buddy, because you're going to have to do the job of a lifetime. These guys right now are out for blood. It's down to that point where you've got to get after it, and everybody knows it.
All right. Now certainly with the short amount of time and our nerves in watching, there is the wife of Mike McLaughlin observing and has been a nervous wreck. You talk
She's making me nervous watching her.
Look at those legs go. You talk about spotters having a tough job. I think she's got a pretty difficult position there as well, Jeff.
I really have a lot of empathy for a driver's wife because they really have nothing they can do. All they can do is sit there and watch and pray that nothing happens to their husbands and that they can get through the day.
All right, and Mike McLaughlin, as you just saw in the 20 car, the leader at the moment, his wife hanging in there, as is our crew, and you'll see every minute of it here as we are ready to close things out. His last Busch Series victory came in 1998 at Charlotte from Waterloo, New York. Let's go back upstairs to Mike Joy.
There are 17 cars on the lead lap, Chris. Now, the last three of those are damaged. Tim Sauter, Andy Kirby, and Bobby Hamilton Jr. So let's have a look back. It'll be a single file restart, and there are 14 cars that could win this. McLaughlin, there's Jimmy Spencer in second. Here's Mike Skinner third. The yellow car is Jeff Green in fourth. Todd Bodine, the black car, in fifth place. Elton Sawyers fought his way up to sixth. There's Greg Biffle, that little dent in the left front corner from Purvis. Kenny Wallace is eighth in the number 48. Chad Little is ninth in the 74. Jay Sauter is 10th in the 43. Then the 37 of Kevin Grubb, the lucky 14 of Larry Foyt. Rich Bickle has a little damage on his 59, and then Tony Raines, and then Tim Sauter, Andy Kirby, and Bobby Hamilton Jr. Those are the lead lap cars.
It's become very obvious to me that if you're going to pass that 20 car, you're about going to have to knock him out of the way because he's not going to give the lead away to Jimmy Spencer. He took him to the grass down the back. He cut him down on the apron down the front. He wants to win this race pretty badly, and he's got a good enough car to do it if he can get it to the finish line.
And Darrell, his strategy seems to be, if you're going to beat me, you're going to have to go around me on the outside.
And Spencer tried that. Now, he and Skinner might be able to get out there and do it together, but they can't do it working against each other.
And Larry, every time they go outside, Jeff Green snuggles right up to McLaughlin.
That's the problem that Spencer and Skinner's got. Not only Mike McLaughlin in front of them, they got Jeff Green, Todd Bodine, who has a strong race car behind them, and we have got a single file restart, four laps to go.
Big space here between these first cars here. Everybody's trying to anticipate this start to get a good head of steam, get a good run on the guy going down into turn one.
Single file restart, here we go, and four cars are going to get away a bit, and here comes Skinner with a great restart.
As soon as the green flag was out, he moved to the outside, but you can do that before you get to the start finish line.
Yeah, he really laid back and he anticipated that start well. There was a big gap between he and Spencer, and he anticipated that start.
What they're liking right here was Jeff Green in the 10, Spencer and the one running side by side. They finally get back in line in turn two.
I don't believe Skinner's got the car to pass. I believe that Jimmy Spencer does. And I believe this is the best thing that could happen for Mike McLaughlin.
And Jeff Green doesn't. You saw how quickly he dropped into line. And now he's kind of losing touch with the front three.
And he better get up there and hang on to the back of those first three, or he'll be in a real race just to hang on to fourth place.
Saw Bobby Hamilton Jr. still on the lead lap. I think his day may finally be done. Look at Mike Skinner all the way to the bottom of the racetrack. Uh-uh. Spencer to the high side.
McLaughlin will not give up the bottom.
He is not going to give up that bottom. You're going to have to pass him in the grass or knock him in the grass.
Three laps to go.
It's going to get tense, guys, right here at the front. You've got three guys up there that want to win this race badly, and the guy in fourth place just wants to finish and take over the point lead.
Spencer went to the high side, thought Jeff Green and the 10 would go with him. Green stays with Skinner in the 21 car.
There's Hamilton, who needs to get off the racetrack. Skinner looks on the outside. Does he have the power?
Here he comes. He's got the run.
And Todd Bodine on the bottom.
We saw Terry Labonte win this race two or three years ago down here by making that outside pass.
Todd Bodine, another Pontiac. He's going to stay with Mike McLaughlin. Moves up on Skinner.
white flag. Two to go. I'm sorry.
You got excited, Darrell.
I thought it was a white flag. I'm wanting it to be the white flag.
And McLaughlin gets a little bit of breathing room.
That's
Harlan.
Good news, bad news. He don't want to get too far out there. Let these guys get a little run on him.
As long as he needs to work both sides of the lane, right, both sides of the aisle right now. Run down the middle, pull that inside, and then cut to the outside. He got them side by side behind him. Work both sides of the track.
Look at Spencer coming to the high side. Going to pull Kenny Wallace with him on the high side.
McLaughlin stays right downstairs.
Spencer's the guy to beat. He's got the car. If he can just get room to pass.
And he needs some help. Darrell, he has no help up there right now.
Nobody seems to want to go with him. They all seem to want to help Mike McLaughlin.
But he moves the car away. That helps his car accelerate. He's coming down to the white flag.
And he edges McLaughlin almost onto the apron. McLaughlin leads the white flag lap by 3 feet.
Got to get behind somebody here.
And back comes McLaughlin.
Boy, he got a run off the middle of one and two. Time bone out. He right up on the rear bumper here, turn two. Half a lap to go.
Katie,
on,
can you stand it?
Both sides of the track. Pull that outside, then drop down to the inside. Work both sides.
Look at him. He don't know where to go. He don't know where to block the bottom
yes,
of the
he
top.
Does. He's staying downstairs, Larry.
Here they
if
come.
If Spencer beats him up top, let him go.
He's doing what I thought he should do. He's working both sides. If Jimmy Spencer can't get a run off of two here, off of four here to the line, I believe the guy's going to hold him off.
He knows. Look at him, right to the bottom. He knows he's got to protect that bottom.
He just left him right there with that drive to the bottom.
Will it be enough? It 75 he races since he's been to victory lane.
What
Mike McLaughlin.
What a run.
Wins the Subway 300. Spencer is second. Green is third.
Looks like Bodine had Skinner for fourth, and Skinner will finish fifth. What a finish.
That was amazing racing.
First Talladega win in 8 starts for the man they call Magic Shoes from Waterloo, New York, Steve Burns.
Well, Mike, we had Katie McLaughlin, but the crew just lifted her over the pit wall. She'd jump by herself.
Come on, baby, get in here.
See if we can get in here. Katie. No, we've lost her. She's in the middle of the huddle right now. Let's see if we can.
I don't think that's a happy bunch.
Well, Mike, as you said, it's been 75 starts. Katie.
Team prayer.
Now she's worried about how she looks.
We've been trying for 2 minutes to get to you. Are you okay? Can your nerves stand this?
Oh, I'm so excited for him. I can't stand it. He needed this run so bad. And I don't know. I'm just so happy for him. He said, oh, my God, I got a Speedway win. I'm excited.
Well, you wore us out watching you.
I wore myself out. I'm exhausted, but I'm ready to party now.
Go celebrate.
We need a sponsor,
come
too.
On,
we
Katie.
Need a
Let's go.
Now, that's a good point. This team does not have a major sponsor.
I don't know if Julie was
from first to 11th place, 1.1 seconds.
What a finish.
In the blink of an eye, Mike McLaughlin holds off Jimmy Spencer by 12/100ths of a second. Jeff Green is third. Todd Bodine, Mike Skinner, Elton Sawyer, Jay Sauter, Greg Biffle, Kevin Grubb, Kenny Wallace, and Chad Little recovered by 1.1 seconds. Larry Foyt up for 12, and then those damaged cars on the tail end of the lead lap back through Andy Kirby.
Wow. I'm telling you guys, here I am. I started to show my hands sweating and ending with the sweat.
Darrell, we got to do this again tomorrow
we
for
500 miles.
And you know what they call this here? Typical Talladega finish.
Oh, yeah. Oh, wow. Yeah, everybody's kind of like, oh, well, another Talladega.
Matt Yocum.
Well, Jimmy Spencer, you went from the outhouse to the penthouse, the outhouse, all on the last lap. What happened?
We still got second. Just no help there, Dan. You know, you're a Winston Cup driver against them Busch guys. You're not going to get no help. So we lost all the teammates we had. We had Jeff Purvis helping us today, and, you know, Mike Skinner helped us there. But what are you going to do? We're happy with the yellow race at Chevrolet. Ran really good, but I'll tell you what, Mike McLaughlin drove a very dirty race. He won, though, but I don't forget.
You were pointing fingers at someone. Was that Todd Bodine?
Well, he's supposed to be my teammate, and you saw what the hell he did, too. But that's fine, you know, because Jimmy Spencer never forgets.
McLaughlin the winner. Spencer finishes second.
But guys, Mike McLaughlin did what he needed to do.
Yep.
He protected the lead.
And remember, as Jimmy Spencer remembers, those two have been beating Nerf bars on the modified circuit since the middle 80s. You know, Spencer won two championships, McLaughlin won one. They're old adversaries.
I don't know who was helping McLaughlin. I don't know who his spotter is, but I tell you one thing, he did a whale of a job.
Kevin Harvick managed to hang on to the point lead. Jason Keller, Greg Biffle, Jeff Green, Jimmy Swanson. Curtis Markham, who is a former Busch Series driver, is Mike McLaughlin's sponsor, and Darrell, that's just what we talked about earlier.
Give me a driver to spot. He knows what to do.
Well, the McLaughlin family is going to celebrate there in Victory Lane. I saw Greg Zipidelli, I think, there in Victory Lane. Now, he and Mike worked together. It was Zipidelli's family, the Carrazzos, that owned the car. McLaughlin won the modified championship with. Our MBNA winner's circle awaits Mike McLaughlin, who got his first Talladega win today, his sixth NASCAR Busch Series win. And he becomes the eighth driver to win in nine races this year.
This series is quite a series. It don't matter where these guys go. They put on a well of a race.
Fontana, California, next weekend, and we'll be there as the NASCAR Busch Series rolls on.
It kind of turns out to be the good guys and the bad guys. You know, these guys want to beat the Winston Cup guys. And so it's a real rivalry, and it really showed up here today, how the Busch guys really worked together and hung the old Winston Cup boys out to dry.
Steve Burns.
With Todd Bodine. Todd, tell us about the end of that race.
Pretty fun, huh? Pretty wild. It was a neat race. We didn't quite have the car to win, I don't think. We needed somebody to pull at us and somebody pushing us. I had to position myself at the bottom of the racetrack. I couldn't let them get to the outside. I got up there before, and I went backwards, so I knew I couldn't do that. So, you know, Jimmy's mad at me for not going with him on the outside, but I had to protect the bottom against Jeff Green, those guys, and I still didn't do a good job against Jeff because he passed me. But Georgia Pacific Pontiac was decent. You know, it's the same car we had at Daytona and got crashed there, got a whole new body, and it came out running real good.
All right, thanks, Todd. Let's go to Dick Berger in Victory Lane.
Mike McLaughlin climbs out to the jubilation of his crew. It is a big, big day. He, wow, dives into their arms. This guy had not even led a lap until last week, since October of 1999. And here he is now, Victory Lane, the biggest win of his entire life. Covered with beer, surrounded by his crew and his wife, Katie. What a moment. Magic Shoes, how bad did you want to win that thing?
I wanted it bad. It was a short track race. That's the way I looked at it. Protect the bottom. Do what you had to do. I'll tell you what. Oh, and my little buddy.
That's Max.
Max. Hey, buddy. My little buddy. These guys are awesome. Joe Gibbs put together a great group here. Tim Shutt, all these guys. Great stops. We did what we had to do.
You protected the bottom. I was listening to your spotter telling you at one point, give it up, and you stuck with it. You hung on.
Well, that's what got us to the front, so I figured the only thing to do was to stick with it. And I'll tell you what, this is a great organization. It's going to make somebody a nice home when they come on board as a major sponsor, I'm telling you. And I hope Dad was watching, man.
All right, congratulations to Chris Myers.
All right, nice to see the McLaughlin family celebrating sixth career victory for Mike McLaughlin. Jeff Hammond, real quick, Jimmy Spencer, some stinging remarks afterwards. Sounded like Tony Soprano saying he ran a dirty race, referring to McLaughlin. He said, I'll never forget. What did he mean by that?
He just means he's mad because he couldn't do it to him. That's exactly what he means.
Was McLaughlin dirty or not?
Not my way of looking at it. I thought he did an excellent job of protecting the inside. When you're out front with two or three laps to go, hey, that thing's going to get wide. It's going to get real wide. If I could make that thing as wide as the racetrack, I would too. The man's wanting to win a race, Jimmy. Give him a break.
And Mike McLaughlin, his first win at Talladega. Nothing subpar about the Subway 300. You'll want to be with us tomorrow. More of the same. It begins on Fox Sports Net with NASCAR this morning, 10 Eastern, 7 Pacific. Our pre-race show on Fox, the mothership, 12:30 Eastern before the Talladega 500. Tony Stewart will join us. We'll talk to the wives of some of the drivers involved at NASCAR Victory Lane. Wraps things up on Fox Sports Net. Kevin Harvick came in as the points leader on the Busch Series and left as the points leader, although he was in for a rough ride. There were a number of mishaps. Joe Nemechek led for a while. Jimmy Spencer ran out of gas, got back in the race. Nemechek, who won this twice before, fell by the wayside. A 16-car crash. Everybody walked away okay, but the biggest winner, Mike McLaughlin, sixth career win with Katie acting as his spotter and number one cheerleader. Thanks for being with us on Fox. We'll see you on Sunday.